To be in London, it's cocktail hour, ladies and gentlemen. It's 5 p.m. somewhere. It's 5 o'clock in London. Why don't you go ahead and have a cocktail if you're in London? Because you're entitled to it. Number one. Number two, who's gonna know? Because this is, after all, a virtual summit, and we're glad that you all are here. This is the second virtual summit we've done, but it is the third year of what we call Healthy Returns, where we examine healthcare, innovation, and investing. And this is, of course, the first time we have done Healthy Returns all virtually. We are, of course, in extraordinary times, facing extraordinary challenges. We're going to examine today some of the most important healthcare issues that we face right now, virtually all of them related to COVID-19. We have an amazing lineup of guests, people from all across the world of healthcare and pharmaceuticals, the CEOs of Bristol Myers Squibb, Moderna, Regeneron, Pfizer, and many, many more. It will be a day of vitally important conversation for all of you, and we hope a forum for great ideas, some of which may be investable ideas, some of which may spark other conversations that you will have with your colleagues and associates. And of course, we want to thank our sponsors, because doing an event like this is impossible without our sponsors. Number one, Hospital for Special Surgery. They have been with us from day one on Healthy Returns. And we welcome as well Vanda Pharmaceuticals. Again, they have stuck with us as we went through the transition of taking this event from a live event to a virtual one. And we are extraordinarily grateful to them. We're grateful to you as well. We're delighted that you could be with us. We're able to accommodate many more people here virtually than we ever could if we were in close surroundings in a physical location. We want you to join the conversation, and virtualizing the event makes that maybe even easier. You can share your questions and constructive comments in the chat feature. You see the arrow that is pointing to it right up there in the right corner, top right, at least it is on my screen, top right, as I look at it. You can also get social with us. Our handle is at CNBC Events, and the hashtag for this event is Healthy Returns, all one word. So that's the way to get social. You can also go into the networking arrow area. The arrow there will show you where the networking arrow is. You can interact and run into a fellow attendees, make some new connections, and a red dot there. When you see a red dot, that means that someone would like to connect with you. There's only one rule here today. Well, really two. One is that you participate and enjoy what you're doing. And the other is that every time I use the word extraordinary, unprecedented, or out of an abundance of caution, I expect you to chug a cocktail. That's the only rules we got there, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to begin now with a conversation on where things stand right now in the coronavirus. On this really historic day, where the head of the CDC, the FDA, and Anthony Fauci are testifying in front of the Senate, we have experts to bring to you. We are going to begin with two people who are as knowledgeable and insightful on this as any people I know, who have been performing above and beyond the call of duty. I don't know when they sleep, by the way. Meg Tirell is CNBC's senior health and science reporter, and Dr. Scott Gottlieb. He has become one of the nation's go-to people, most trusted voices on healthcare. He is a former head of the FDA, now a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, board member of Illumina and Pfizer, and he is a CNBC contributor. Dr. Gottlieb, welcome back. We're delighted to have you with us. I'm going to begin with a poll question for our general audience, and then I'll turn the question to you if you don't mind. And the poll question is, in terms of the coronavirus, if we were to use the baseball metaphor, and maybe it's a little overused, what inning would we be in? The second, the fifth, the eighth? So I'll turn that question, as the audience gets to answer, I'll turn that question to you. What inning are we in? And maybe more importantly and more tellingly, are we going to have a doubleheader?
Well, thanks for having me here today. Should I take a first, Beck? I think probably the second inning. Yeah, I think it's probably the second inning. We've now seen the virus whip around the world, and we've now grappling with our own epidemic here in the United States, and are starting to plateau and hopefully come down the epidemic curve. Although we're seeing cases rise in a lot of parts of the nation when you get outside the Pacific Northwest and parts of California and the tri-state region around New York City. But I think that we're going to be facing a very different threat heading into the fall and into the winter and then probably into the spring again, as this settles into a more seasonal pattern until we can get to a vaccine or until this just has a slow burn through the country and we get to a point where we have what is effectively herd immunity. I mean, the doubling time right now is about every month. So the epidemic itself is doubling every 45 days. If you look at a report put out by Morgan Stanley today, some other modeling shows it's doubling every month. So at some point you get to a level of exposure if we continue on this slow burn where a lot of people have had it and transmission will start to slow down. But this is still the early innings to this epidemic.
Let me pick up on something you just said, and it is an important one. And Meg, I'll come to you in just a moment on this very same topic. And it goes to the question of mitigation. You said that if you strip out the tri-state area, the Pacific Northwest and California, and you look at American case counts, they are still rising. That would call into question, wouldn't it, the effectiveness of all this mitigating that we've been trying to do. So the question is, has mitigation helped us? Has it worked? Partially worked. If we didn't do all this mitigation, would we have succeeded to the same degree we have in flattening the curve? In other words, would the case count be even steeper? So would you address that whole topic of mitigation and whether if we hadn't mitigated our fannies off, we'd be in a worse place than we are today?
Right. Well, it's a little unfair for me to talk about the country without talking about New York, although we are looking at data outside New York as we start to assess the reopening, because had New York not happened, had you not had the scope of the epidemic that you did in New York, the administration that might not have made the decision to shut down the country and do population-wide mitigation across the entire United States. But remember, the primary objective of mitigation was to slow the spread and keep the peak number of cases below the point at which the healthcare system would become overwhelmed. And we were primarily concerned about New York, but also other cities like New Orleans and Detroit and Chicago, Philadelphia, Los Angeles, that also had large outbreaks. So mitigation did succeed at its primary purpose, which was to keep the healthcare system from becoming exhausted and keep the number of deaths down, because we know from experience around the world and other epidemics that the death count starts to rise rapidly when the healthcare system becomes overwhelmed. That's certainly what happened in Italy, and it's what started to happen in Wuhan as well. I think what most of us figured, though, and I certainly believed, was that mitigation was also going to have a pretty profound impact on the spread in terms of leading to sustained reductions in new cases, as you had seen in other countries, and certainly as you'd seen Europe. And China was the starkest example of this, where their mitigation caused the epidemic curve to be largely symmetric, where they went up their epidemic curve very fast, but came down it quickly as well. And you've seen Europe come down their epidemic curve. What you've seen in the United States, though, with the exception of the tri-state region, is more of a flattening. We've reached a plateau, but we're not starting to see those steady declines yet. And that was a surprise. That wasn't the primary objective of mitigation, but we all believe that that was going to be an outcome of it. Now, if you want to be optimistic, in the last week, we have seen cases come down a little bit. We've had about an average of around 27,000 cases a day. and 1,700 deaths. That's down from about 30,000 and 2,000 deaths. So maybe we're starting to show some slow declines, but it's probably too early to tell.
You know, Meg, a lot of people say that you can't really expect to reopen the economy until you have a vaccine that really works, or B, treatment protocols that really can either cure or blunt the health effects of this illness. So give us your latest read on where we are with respect to vaccines, the forecast for when one might be widely commercially available, and where we stand in terms of therapies for this disease.
Well, in terms of the vaccine, I mean, these timelines are moving faster than anything we've ever seen before. Multiple vaccines are already in human clinical trials. And you're hearing companies talk about having millions of doses potentially available by the end of this year. Now, whether that would be broadly commercially available is probably unlikely. That is extremely fast. And I'd be interested in hearing Dr. Gottlieb's thoughts on this as well. But even to have something next year, in that 12 to 18 month timeframe, we kept hearing and we keep hearing Dr. Fauci talk about, everything has to go right and really go right the first time. The good news is we have a lot of shots on goal, and we are hearing talk about that now. You know, this morning, of course, Dr. Fauci and others are testifying to the Senate Health Committee. And one thing he said in response to a question about whether schools will have vaccines and drugs to help them safely reopen in the fall, he said, that's a bridge too far. But what they want to know in the fall in terms of coming back is, will we be safe? And for that, he said, we need that extensive testing and surveillance system up and running that Dr. Gottlieb's been talking about. And Tyler, if you don't mind my shifting chairs to the questioner, I would love to ask Dr. Gottlieb about something he said earlier, which is the idea that we might actually reach herd immunity before we even potentially have a vaccine. You tweeted a paper, it was a preprint, so it's not been peer reviewed, that showed we might reach herd immunity at a much lower level than was thought. You know, we've been hearing people say 60 to 70% of the population needs to be infected to get herd immunity. Are you now thinking the scientific community may be saying that could be lower, we could reach it sooner?
Well, the classic teaching is that if you have an R naught, so if you have a reproduction rate of 2, then to reach herd immunity, you need to infect 50% of the population. If the reproduction rate is 3, then you need 66%, and sort of 1/R0, there's just a formula to it. But in practicality, and what these two papers that came out recently modeled, in practicality, not everyone's equally susceptible to the infection. And so the infection will first strike people who are most susceptible to it. And then the people who don't get the infection, some proportion of them, or maybe a large proportion, don't get it because they're not susceptible to it, either because of genetic reasons. Maybe they were exposed to a lot of other coronaviruses and somehow that gives them some cross immunity, or they have some genetic feature that makes them less vulnerable to it, or because they're people who just don't go out a lot because of what they do. Maybe they stay in and they're just not susceptible, but you have to look at them as people who are less vulnerable to the infection. So in practical measures, you might reach herd immunity at a lower threshold, something like 40%. The paper suggested it might be half of what you would assume, but even something at like 40% would be a lot less. And if you look at a city like New York, where the seroprevalence studies that were done in April 19th, they were in the field doing those studies, they found about 20% of the population had been exposed and had neutralizing antibodies. That might've been a little high at that point, but assuming that was about right, perhaps by the end of May into June, you'll have maybe 30% of New York exposed by the time this epidemic runs its full course, at least this wave. That gets you pretty close to maybe 40% that might be required to achieve herd immunity. And now to take this one step further, if we have persistent infection through the summer at current levels, we reach this plateau of 30,000 cases a day, which is really probably about 300,000 cases a day because we're diagnosing probably 1 in 10, maybe less than that. But assuming we have this sort of slow burn of infection through the summer, by September 1st, you'll have infected 15% of the US population. So you're starting to get to levels where you haven't quite reached herd immunity, but transmission could potentially be slowed in the cities, particularly the dense cities where you're having more infection. Now, that doesn't help you if you're out in parts of the country that haven't really been exposed to the infection. There's a lot of parts of the country, but at least in the dense population centers, you're going to have more exposure.
So let me ask another question to Meg, and then I'll get you your thought on this as well, Dr. Gottlieb. What do we know, and how promising do we think, Meg, these post-COVID exposure plasma donations may be as a therapy? That's question one. And what do we know about the effectiveness and reliability of the so-called antibody tests? Because I'm reading that there are antibody tests that are not terribly effective, that people who had tested positive for the disease are not showing up as having any antibodies to the disease.
There are so many questions about these antibody tests, and our understanding of them has really just been evolving in the last few weeks. I remember maybe a month or two ago when we first went into this shelter in place, I was having a conversation with my husband and my in-laws. How much would we pay for an at-home antibody test to know that we're immune? And we were saying $500 a piece, you know, just like it would be such a valuable piece of information. We'd pay so much money to have it. And as we've started to understand what these antibody tests actually tell us, I think the amount we'd be willing to pay has gone down, and even our willingness to go out and get one of these antibody tests. And a lot of that understanding, of course, is coming from people like Dr. Gottlieb, whose, you know, opinion I'd love to hear about this. But going back to your convalescent plasma question, so this is a very old approach to trying to treat disease, taking the plasma from people who have recovered from the disease and counting on the antibodies that their immune systems developed to try to treat the disease for other people. I think that approach is promising for treating COVID-19, and of course is the foundation for many of the approaches we're going to be talking about today, including with Regeneron's CEO, where they're developing their own antibodies based on mouse technology. Fascinating stuff, and I'll wait for that panel to talk about it more. But certainly there is promise there. On the antibody test front, though, so many tests flooded the market because the FDA really opened the floodgates to them. Now they've had to say, hold on, some of these don't actually work that well. We've really got to reel that in. And there are about a dozen that are approved, and you can see their sensitivity and specificity data on the FDA website, and they are pretty high. But even so, Dr. Gottlieb has told us he would get at least two antibody tests if he got a positive, just to make sure it was right.
Yeah. What about that, Dr. Gottlieb? How effective are these antibody tests? And what about the idea that some people get the disease, test positive, but don't present antibodies? So how immune can we become?
Well, this virus behaves like every other virus, and there's no reason to expect that it wouldn't. You're going to develop, it seems it's very immunogenic. You're going to develop antibodies to the virus, and those antibodies are going to be protective for a period of time. They're neutralizing antibodies that are going to afford a level of protection for a period of time, perhaps about a year. It's going to be highly variable. Some people will develop less antibodies and will have less immunity than others, but we should just assume that most people are going to develop a level of immunity that's going to last a period of time of around a year, perhaps less than some people. The antibody tests themselves, there's more reliable tests coming onto the market. The Quest test is reliable, the Abbott test, the Roche test. Mount Sinai published details of their test in Nature Medicine, I believe today, that shows how reliable that test is, a very specific and sensitive test. So you're going to have better tests on the market. I still don't think these should be used for individual patient decision making. You shouldn't go out and get a test and find out you have antibodies and sort of that signals the all clear, because there is a high false positive rate, meaning the test can tell you that you have antibodies when you really don't, because some of these tests will cross react with other antibodies. But if you want to rely on the test, if you want to go out and get it and rely on a positive result, a result that says you have antibodies, I would repeat it twice, because the positive predictive value of two positive tests is very high. So if you have a test and it says you have antibodies and you get it done again and it says you have antibodies again, that's probably a result that you can rely on.
Right. I'm going to go to a quick lightning round and ask for quick answers, Dr. Gottlieb, as we're sort of tight on time. Would you let your child go to a summer day camp this summer?
I'd be more skeptical of day camp than sleepaway camp, frankly. I think sleepaway camps have the potential to create a protective bubble that's easier than for day camps.
Would you let your child or a family member go to a public swimming pool or even a swimming pool at a swim club somewhere? You worried about that?
Yeah, I'm hopeful that there's going to be a seasonal effect here, and we're going to see cases start to decline in July and August, and we can all take a little bit of a breather in the summer. I'm very worried about the fall when we come back, but I'm hopeful that infection starts to break off later in the summer.
Meg is a new mom. Should she be worried about this new, or relatively new mom, should she be worried about this new manifestation of coronavirus that seems to mimic Kawasaki disease, which my son, my older son, once had.
Yeah, well, we should certainly be worried about it. What we don't understand is the denominator. How many kids have had coronavirus? We know that some kids appear to be getting some kind of post-viral condition, which isn't unheard of with other viruses. You see post-viral conditions with Coxsackie or flu, but millions of kids have Coxsackie and flu every year. So the question is, how many kids are getting coronavirus? And are we seeing a small number with these conditions, or is it a large number relative to a total pool of kids who are getting infected in the first place?
All right, Meg Tirell, we'll see you later today. Thank you so much. Dr. Gottlieb, I sit here and I go, there's Fauci, there's Gottlieb, LeBron, MJ. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being so available and inviting us into your home. And into your home as well, Meg. We'll see you in just a little bit, by the way. Dr. Gottlieb, have a good rest of the day. All right, we're all hoping, of course, that we'll be able to find a vaccine and effective treatments. We talked a little bit about that just then, and pharmaceutical companies are trying to speed both of those to market, and we're moving at a very fast clip. Big Pharma, of course, has suffered its share of slings and arrows in recent years, reputational damage over drug pricing, executive pay, and the sort, and whether they are putting too much emphasis on profit and not enough on patients. But here, the entire industry has been moving in concert to provide life-saving treatments. Their mission, of course, may be muddied just a little bit by some of the reputational damage that has gone before. We've got a second poll question. You can respond into the poll section on the right of your screen as you look at it. And the discussion now turns to the whole idea of what pharmaceutical companies are doing and their role in helping to solve this public health disaster that has befallen the world. There's perhaps no better person that I can think of to discuss this than Giovanni Caforio. He is the outgoing chairman of the industry group PhRMA. He is also the CEO of Bristol Myers Squibb. He engineered the massive merger with Celgene last year, and he is in the midst of a monumental transformation of the company, even as he leads the way on research to combat COVID. Interviewing is him is my friend and our stalwart, Jim Cramer. He is, of course, the host of Mad Money and the co-anchor of Squawk on the Street. Here's Jim.
We're here with Dr. Giovanni Caforio, who's chairman and CEO of Bristol Myers Squibb and chairman of PhRMA. Thank you so much for joining us for CNBC's Healthy Returns. Dr. Giovanni, how did we get here? I need your advice. The world needs your advice. You're a doctor. You're head of a major pharmaceutical company. And it's a scary time. And the only people we have to look to are people like you who are being thrust into a position. You're a CEO, but now you're much more than that. What do we do? What do we tell our kids?
Jim, thanks for having me during these really important times. So first of all, let me say, I am a physician. I'm a believer in science, and so I'm optimistic. When you look at the polls, the public is really counting on the government and the industry during this time of crisis. And the biopharmaceutical industry can play and is playing a really important role. That's who we are, and this is what we do. We've had health crisis before, and we've been able to work together and develop the right medicines and the right vaccines to overcome issues. And this is what we are doing now. I see an unprecedented level of cooperation between companies in our industry. We are working with the FDA, the National Institutes of Health, the Gates Foundation. We're coming together to bring resources and expertise together. And we are making great progress already in a short period of time. For us, at Bristol Myers Squibb, as a leader in the industry, we are also playing an important role. And it really is for every patient, not just for patients infected and impacted by COVID. We are accelerating the pipeline medicines that can be helpful in the treatment of some of the effects of the disease. We're helping patients with our medicines. Of course, we're very present with helping our communities everywhere we can. So I can say I am really optimistic about how we are coming together to manage this crisis.
Well, I don't want to create any false optimism. I feel that from the very beginning, we were behind. When I say we, I mean the world. This is such a terrible illness. We didn't seem to be able to realize how nefarious it was. Do you think we've caught up to it? Do you think that we're on to this terrible illness, and we're starting to see what terrible things it can do, and we're going to be able to blunt them?
Well, first of all, one of the things that we are doing is we are learning, and the adaptability and the ability to learn from experience is really important today. I think it's going to be incredibly important going forward. There is progress with the development of diagnostics. That is a critical component. And also we are seeing companies in our industry come together to start clinical trials with potential new treatments for the disease. So the same is true for vaccines. And so I believe we are making progress. It will take some time. At the same time, I believe it really is important to continue to work together. In our industry, we have a lot of experience, and we bring in that to the table in order to advance the solution to this very terrible pandemic, as you said.
Now, for example, I know we have done work with Glaxo and Sanofi. They're not friends, but they're teaming up. You're giving away 1,000 compounds in your discovery library. I mean, that's sacred stuff, but you're just opening it up because you want to solve this pandemic.
Yeah, Jim, we're doing a number of things. So we did make 1,000 compounds from our library available to external researchers to investigate whether they can have a role to play. We also have a number of medicines that are on the market already that can be tested because they're potentially active against some of the inflammatory symptoms of the disease that are so severe. And we're working with other companies to initiate clinical trials together. We are also, as an industry, beginning to look at manufacturing capacity so that we can bring that together when a new treatment is developed and is proven to be effective with patients. And so there is a lot going on, but I think what's also important is to continue to really focus on every patient. And so in our case at Bristol Myers Squibb, for example, we took action early on. We understand that because of the economic consequences of disease, patients may struggle. We wanted to make sure that no patient had issues accessing one of our existing medicines. And so we expanded our patient support program early on in the US so that any patient that has lost the job and potentially healthcare coverage because of the pandemic, they will receive Bristol Myers Squibb medicines for free. So there are multiple ways in which a company like ours is taking a leadership role and helping with the pandemic. And they go all the way from research to the medicines that are already approved in the marketplace.
Let's talk about people. I've gotten to know you. I know the people who run pretty much every single major pharma and the people before you. I've always felt that the industry attracted some of the greatest minds, terrific people. Bob Eugen, the man who really made Celgene take off before you bought that, fabulous guy. I've known Roy Vagelos. I knew him at Merck. I mean, these have always been amazing people, and yet the industry has gotten bad name after bad name after bad name. Why did it take a pandemic for people to figure out who you really were and who you are? Because you're the same people the whole time. You've always felt like this. Now you've given a chance, but why did it take this? Why didn't people know that you guys are the good guys?
Well, Jim, let me say, first of all, that we have been focusing on patients for a long time. And the innovation that has been developed thanks to the work of our researchers and the people in our industry has helped address so many diseases over the years, from HIV/AIDS to hepatitis C, and of course, infectious diseases from MERS and SARS and influenza. I know there is increased appreciation for the role we play. I think it's really important. we have a major role to play in addressing this epidemic. And the level of cooperation between our companies in the industry, it's really unprecedented this time. The level of resources, expertise we're bringing into the table, the way in which we're working together with other stakeholders, I think that is unprecedented. And I'm seeing great progress already. So I know that we're all focusing on patients and we're trying to make progress as soon as possible. But that's really who we are as an industry. That's what we do. It's the same mission that animates Bristol Myers Squibb. We've never stopped working during the entire pandemic. Our essential workers have remained in our manufacturing plants, and we've continued to deliver medicines to patients around the world. We've continued to focus on advancing our pipeline because there are new medicines that will be needed by patients in the future. And I'm really proud of what our people at Bristol Myers Squibb and across the industry, really, what we're accomplishing.
Well, I'm glad you brought up what you're doing at Bristol Myers Squibb, because I think that you've got, at full disclosure, my travel trust has a big position. I think you've got the most underappreciated pipeline. Now, maybe that's because of the merger with Celgene. Maybe people didn't realize some of the things you're working on. But maybe you can just tell the audience the pipeline is full, and it looks to me like you have many very big drugs that we're going to see in the next 4 or 5 years.
Well, Jim, thank you. First of all, as you know, just a few days ago, we reported our first quarter results. It was a really important quarter because it was the first quarter for the new Bristol Myers Squibb after the acquisition of Celgene. It was a great quarter. We had $10.8 billion in sales for the quarter, which represents a pro forma growth of 8% for our business. We did well across the board. I'm really proud of how our people are continuing to execute during this time. The great thing about the quarter was the progress we made with the pipeline. We had the approval of a very important medicine, Zeposia, ozanimod, that you know well, Jim, and it was approved by the FDA, patients with multiple sclerosis. We had the approval of another medicine called Reblozyl, which is really important for patients with myelodysplastic syndrome. These are patients that have anemia, and there has been no new medicine approved for many, many years. That was approved by the FDA. We advanced Opdivo with two positive phase 3 clinical trials in kidney cancer and a really serious form of lung cancer called mesothelioma. I am really proud of the progress we're making with the pipeline, and we're executing really, really well. You know, we are in the middle of an integration, and actually, the integration has been accelerated by what is happening, because as we work together remotely and focusing on helping patients during a difficult time, our people have come together even faster. We're creating one culture for the new company really, really well. So the pipeline is progressing really well. Bristol Myers Squibb is a leading biopharma company. We're very well positioned for the future.
But Giovanni, you have a drug that I think is radically underappreciated. It's something quite unusual, I think, in pharma. It's a vastly superior drug to others in its category. And yet people, it took a little while, I know maybe 5, 6 years to recognize Eliquis. I think it is best in class. Tell me why that shouldn't have 100% of the market when you look at the data.
Well, Eliquis is a really important medicine. It's one of the most important medicines for Bristol Myers Squibb. More importantly, is the leading medicine around the world for the prevention of stroke in patients with atrial fibrillation. It's a very serious condition that affects millions of patients. And Eliquis is the market leader because it has a best-in-class profile in terms of efficacy and safety. It's being adopted increasingly everywhere in the world, not just in the US. It's the number one new oral anticoagulant in the United States, in a growing number of countries around the world. And there is more potential for growth, in fact, because really of the strong efficacy and good safety of Eliquis, we're seeing continued growth. And there is further opportunity in the future. There are many patients that are not being treated appropriately yet. And in fact, there are many patients with atrial fibrillation that have not yet been diagnosed effectively. We are partnering with technology companies, one Fitbit in particular, where we are experimenting with devices that can help early diagnosis of atrial fibrillation. So Eliquis is doing really well. It's the number one new oral anticoagulant in the world, but there is significant opportunity to continue to grow in the future. It's one of the most important medicines in our portfolio.
When you bought Celgene, all I kept hearing was it's Revlimid, it's going to go off patent. It's not going to be able to be something that is going to be long lasting, and the rest of the stuff is not worth anything. You're proving right now that the view on both Revlimid and on the other compounds is wrong.
You know, Jim, I'm really proud of our people and everything we've accomplished since the acquisition. The performance of the business has continued to be really strong across the board. On all value drivers for the acquisition, where we are executing well, the pipeline is progressing. The approvals of new medicines in the first quarter are really a demonstration of the strong focus we have on the pipeline. We're also doing well from an integration perspective, and we are on track with the $2.5 billion in synergies during the first 3 years. The company is in a really strong financial flexibility with lots financial position with lots of flexibility. So the execution in the new company is really strong. And I believe that as a leading biopharma company, we're very well positioned. So the pipeline is doing quite well.
Now, I know that you talked about science and government working hand in hand. I think a lot of people in America are rediscovering science. When we were going to school and we were little, we knew that the scientists were the smart ones. We all wanted to be scientists, but not everybody was smart enough. And then we got diverted. A lot of people went to law school. They went to business school. Then they went into social media. Do you think it's possible, doctor, that what is happening right now is people are rediscovering the basic goodness of science and making a difference, making not just money, but a difference?
Well, Jim, you know, this is what we do. At Bristol Myers Squibb and in companies in our industry. It's about science and it's about innovation and bringing new medicines to patients. So, of course, we are enthusiastic about what we can do, particularly in a time when there is a health crisis. We are even more focused on bringing our work forward and making a difference for patients. I'm a physician by training. I've been in this industry over 30 years. I can tell you every time I have an opportunity to speak to a patient, it gives me extra energy and it motivates me to continue to work. I am hearing from so many patients this day, even if I'm working remotely, patients are reaching out to tell us they really value what we do. And so this is a time for our industry companies like Bristol Myers Squibb to step up to the challenge, work together, and demonstrate what we are capable of when we work together. That's our industry. That's what we stand for. That's what we are. And this is a time in which the value of science and innovation is becoming very clear. As you mentioned, it is a difficult time, and we should not underestimate the challenges of the current situation, but ultimately it will be science that helps us solve the issues we're facing today.
I don't want to put you totally on the spot, but do you think there ever will be a vaccine for COVID?
You know, Jim, as you know, Bristol Myers Squibb does not have a focus on vaccines. I do know that many companies in our industry do. And they are working together, not only between companies to develop a vaccine faster, to learn from each other, to make sure the right manufacturing capacity is available. There is cooperation with various institutions around the world. Clearly in the US, there is a lot of activity. It will take time, but I am confident that we will have a vaccine developed.
All right, thank you so much. Our thanks to Giovanni Caforio for joining us at CNBC's Healthy Return Summit.
My name is Marcus Bühler. I'm the McAfee Professor of Engineering at MIT. My work deals with proteins and protein materials. When you think about proteins and other molecules, they aren't static, as we might imagine if we open a chemistry textbook. These molecules are continuously moving and vibrating, and so we have thought of ways of modeling these vibrations and making them audible. Resulting music is a 1 hour and 50 minute long piece. It begins with very slow motions. It enters a more chaotic, more disruptive state in the center of the music and ends up being more calming and relaxing towards the end. That's because at the center of the music, we're exploring the inner workings, the inner folding of the protein structure. Not only can we listen to proteins, we can also begin to understand how different proteins are constructed. In other words, why does a protein found in muscle tissue or in heart tissue or maybe in spider silk sound different than proteins found in a virus? Music allows us to understand, to hear what the protein language sounds like or looks like, and we can use, once we understand the language, the insights into developing new drugs or treatments.
That was really fascinating stuff, that proteins can actually create a kind of music. They have their own individual song. Well, we've just heard from the CEO of Bristol Myers Squibb, and he is the first of many. We're going to hear from the CEO of Epic, Moderna, Regeneron, and Pfizer later during the day. Our next discussion is with Jessica Mega. She's the co-founder and chief scientific officer of Verily, and she will be interviewed by CNBC's health and science tech reporter, Chrissy Farr. Chrissy?
Thank you so much for having me here today to talk about testing. And Jess, you and I have talked about this many times because you're in the thick of it right now with Verily. So I thought we could start off by just talking about how not all testing is created equal. There are different types of assays available and they do very different things for different purposes. So maybe you could just walk us through that to start off with. What are some of the key tests that we see on the market today, and what do they do?
So it's great to be here, and I think that's such an important question to really understand the broad swath of tests that we have out there. Some of the early tests that people refer to were those that we call the RT-PCR tests, looking for parts of the virus. Those tend to be very useful when someone is actually in the throes or after they've just been infected, those period of days to weeks afterwards. You also start to hear about antibody tests, and antibodies just reflect the way that the body responds to a given illness, whether it's a virus or a bacteria. Antibodies can be very advantageous. Again, that's why the body can fight all of these different illnesses. But those tend to be on different time scales as well. They're early antibodies, sometimes called IgA or IgM, and then they're later antibodies, the IgG. We heard earlier in the discussion that it is not as simple as just having an antibody passport or being able to say that you know that you would not be someone at risk of the test. So again, those are the antibody tests. And then we have new tests coming out. We have the antigen tests that we recently heard about and CRISPR-based tests. So these tests, as you start to talk to epidemiologists, will be used in different ways. Some of them may be used to understand the basic epidemiology, what is happening in the community, how can we open up communities, how can we get the economics back on track? And then other tests will be used for an individual patient so that we know how best to treat them.
Thank you, Jess. So as Tyler mentioned, there's a lot of wide-ranging numbers out there, whether it's 300,000, 30,000, total numbers of tests as well. I've seen anything from a million in the US to, you know, slightly more than that. So how do we know when we are doing enough tests? Is there a threshold where we can say, okay, we're satisfied with the amount that we're doing, especially as we seek to get into this next phase, which is to reopen the economy?
So if you think about the number of tests that we're doing across the United States today, again, estimates are anywhere between 250 to 300,000. Some people suggest that we actually need two or three times, maybe even more, the number of tests. The interesting thing is it's not as if the same testing strategies are going to be able to work everywhere. For example, in areas that are very rural where they may have more social distancing to begin with, you may have lower event rates than what you're seeing in some of the larger metropolises. On the other hand, what we found at Verily and how we ended up getting involved was working directly with local, state, and federal health officials who said, we have a crisis at hand and we need to get the right tests to the right people. And so as we started to talk with them, what we realized is that it's not just testing, it's actually this concept of smart testing. And at the beginning of the pandemic, as it hit the United States, the risk factors of most interest, things like people traveling to certain geographies. And over time, that became less relevant because we now know that the exposure in the United States is equally high. And so what we were able to do is use tech platforms to enable this ability to get the tests and match them to the people who need them most. We're gonna see more and more around this concept of smart testing, contact tracing, and then ultimately the response on how to handle the communities.
So with the work that Verily's already been doing, both in sort of the drive up testing realm and in making sure that the right people have access to these tests, are you thinking now that the approach needs to be that we've got to segment out that section of the population that's of higher risk, that is maybe experiencing symptoms, and test those people as a priority? Or do we need at this stage moving towards mass testing where, you know, every person is getting tested before they make a decision to go back to work or to return to their lives? And how do we get there?
So there's going to be a series of approaches. In some cases, we know that it will be helpful just to broadly understand the epidemiology. We now understand even the symptoms have changed. It used to be thought that fever or cough were the most common symptoms. Then we went on to learn that changes in smell and taste, and now we even know that asymptomatic patients are out there. So from a community-based perspective, there are going to be programs that are broad-ranging. At the same time, as hotspots pick up, you're going to want to test more frequently. You're going to want to understand the dynamism there. Again, I think that's what we found most rewarding in the program, is this idea of being able to work with a tech platform that we've been building for years called the Baseline Platform that you and I have talked about frequently. This is a platform that was built really to accelerate clinical research and bridge research and care, but being able to turn that into a program that public health officials could use to get that same information, that same kind of data that you might get in a research study, but now apply it to public health. So what we're gonna see is a series of different testing strategies. The same thing can be true once you actually have detected someone and understand that they have the disease. What do we know more about the science and how do we test all of these wonderful therapies and vaccines that are out there? And so if you think about it from a person point of view, and what we've been working on at Verily is not only accelerating screening and testing, but also accelerating the science, running the right studies so that we know what therapies are actually going to improve the lives of patients.
Absolutely. So Tom has joined us, and he is with the company BD, which has been doing a whole lot of work in the testing sphere. And Tom, you've mentioned before with CNBC that your company is working on a whole portfolio of assays as it relates to testing. So what's the update there? How's it going? What have been some of the challenges that you've faced so far? And what are the big opportunities as we get into the next phase of this?
Yeah, sure. Sorry to be a little late there. And obviously, thanks for having me. And Jessica, nice to speak, at least via this forum as well. So we have four different tests that we've launched in the marketplace already. Three are used to help determine who has coronavirus. And those are molecular-based assays that detect the DNA and determine, does the patient have it or not? We've launched two of those in the U.S., and two of those have been launched ex-US. We also had launched a product that helps understand who had coronavirus, which is an antibody-based assay. And again, that's also being used in wide use. I just say, maybe just to build off the discussion that you just had with Jessica as well, testing definitely is a critical part of controlling the pandemic. And we see that around the world. We see that here in the US. I'd also just to share on our experience, we've been deeply involved in infection prevention for more than 10 years. We actually have a software system that more than 500 hospitals use and have used for many, many years around the U.S. that help them control the spread of infections, things like methicillin-resistant drug or organisms, C. diff, et cetera. And we test for those all the time. BD provides lots of tests to prevent, to look for those types of infectious agents in hospitals and other care settings. They use our software to check the spread. We know that testing is an important part, but still when you go to a hospital, the most important part is, are people washing their hands? Are they wearing the proper PPE? And I think that's something that as we think about society in general, we've got to make sure that everyone's keeping in mind the importance of wearing masks, washing hands, taking those general precautions, because while we need to do testing, it's never going to replace the ability of just those basic precautions, masks and hand washing, to prevent the spread.
Tom, you mentioned PPE, which is so vital. And from the beginning of this crisis, we've been running low. So one of the things I've heard discussed is just the importance of at-home testing. Reason being that if people can test themselves, then we are not using PPE for that purpose, and we can conserve it for the patients that need it and the doctors treating them within the health systems. So when do you both think that we get to that type of at-home testing where the patients can truly administer the test themselves and then get that rapid result, say in 15, 20 minutes?
You know, we've been working with the FDA as well as a cohort of diagnostic companies to validate, first off, the ability to use just a dry swab, like a Q-tip like swab, different material but similar. And that's done now. And you've actually got companies like LabCorp, for example, who are allowing a swab to be sent to a patient's home, them to use that nasal swab and send it back for testing. So that's available today. It'll still take a day or two to get that result, potentially a little bit longer. The technology, for example, that Quidel just launched this week, a rapid antigen test, is the type of platform that begins to allow that diagnostic testing to happen much closer to home. Certainly allows it to happen in physician offices, and the technology is simple enough that it would allow it to happen at home. It's still probably not quite there yet, but certainly this line of antigen-based lateral flow technology that's launching is what could allow that to happen. But I'd say for the next month or couple months, it's most likely to be enabled more at the doctor's office or at a retail clinic, but within 10 minutes, a test result.
Mm-hmm. So we've mentioned already this word tracing, and that I've read has been a big part of just the strategy as we think about reopening the economy. It's this dual testing and tracing approach. So I'll start with you, Tom, but can you talk a little bit about how tracing and testing can be used as tools as part of our kit to help curb the spread of this coronavirus?
Yeah, and I think Jessica and Verily have probably been more involved in that than we have. Again, we've been involved in on the informatics side of infectious disease and infection prevention for many, many years, more than a decade. Certainly, if you don't know who has the virus and who they've been exposed to, it's hard to control it. We've seen that certainly our business in parts of Asia and where that's been employed. We are seeing great outcomes from that. In China, we're seeing good outcomes from that, and in other parts of Asia that have deployed tracing technology. I know there's still some issues to work through here in the US, but it certainly can be an important part. And maybe Jessica, you can comment more on that.
Sure. So I think it's so interesting to think about the entire network it's going to take to actually care for people. We've been heavily involved in the screening and testing program, again, understanding how to deploy this in the most logical way. But as you noted, there's this idea of how do you alert the people around you that may be exposed. There is the notion of tracing. There's also the concept of just notification. Some people may want to know, so they can opt in to know, are they someone who has been in the vicinity with someone who's been infected? And there are a number of different groups working on that that you've seen. It's combinations of technology companies working with epidemiologists, working with universities, working with the government. The idea of actual tracing and the way we've seen it deployed, a lot of it goes back to this concept of public health. And so all of the information that's coming through our systems goes directly back to the patients who need it most, and to public health officials who are then doing what they've been doing for years in terms of trying to get to the bottom of an epidemic. I think there's a moment in time where we have such great appreciation for our public health networks. And if anything, I think all of us are thinking about how do we invest in public health even more? How do we allow the people on the front lines that have to make the decisions around what they do in their localities, with their state or their nation, how do they have the right data to make those decisions? And again, this idea of notification and then actual tracing is something that you're going to see continue to evolve, because it's only that way do you get in front of the pandemic.
Absolutely. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to chime in. Otherwise, I have many more of my own. So we've already talked this morning about the idea of an immunity passport, specifically as it relates to the antibody testing. The idea that, you know, if you come back with, say, some exposure that you've already had to coronavirus, does that mean that you should be able to get back on a plane, go back into the office? I wondered if, Tom, you could chime in on whether or not you think that strategy is a good one, or are there reasons that we should be reluctant to embrace it?
I think it's something that we need to seriously consider. Certainly, as we think about, you know, we have about two-thirds of our workforce have actually continued to work throughout this pandemic, because that's our workforce that's in our manufacturing plants. And so we look each and every day at what technologies we can use to make sure that we keep our workforce safe. These are the types of approaches that we've been considering. I think at the end of the day, as those types of tests become more readily available, either the combination of doing real-time antigen testing as people are coming in a facility, whether or not you're doing that daily or on a rotating basis, or the idea of a passport for immunity.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. This idea that it would be, I think, really reassuring if we could just turn to this passport and say, everyone's free and clear once you have the antibodies. As it turns out, it's more complicated than that. We're finding that people have different levels of the antibody after the infection. And so it's going to take a network and a series of tests to actually give us all the confidence. At the same time, it's an area certainly that we're spending time on. How do you not only do the screening and testing, but how do you get people back to work safely? So I believe that we're going to see more and more, but it's not just a simple yes, no, a green, red type of phenomenon at this stage.
So Jess, I would love to talk to you about some of the newer approaches that you're seeing with testing, especially in the first few months. We mostly saw PCR testing. Now I'm hearing talk of CRISPR. We're talking about rapid antigen testing, which could be another method to get to mass testing at some point. So what does the future of testing look like from, you know, just these different approaches that are being experimented with at various companies and at scientific labs around the country currently?
So I think you're right. The original approach of using PCR and using antibodies is something that we've been doing as a medical community for years. It builds off a body of work. And I think that those really do have a very particular place. I don't want to underestimate all of the important work that's been done, for example, with the community-based screening testing programs that you see, which predominantly were based on PCR testing. Currently, we've screened over 50,000 patients using these types of tests, and we feel really confident with the results that end up going back to people. At the same time, there are new technologies. Just in the last week, we've heard about progress with antigens, and this idea that the antigens could really help you in real time, again, slightly different than the antibody testing that we were talking about, is used a little bit more in the later phase. The antigen testing can be quite good. People are looking into it. It tends to be useful if you find that it's positive, but if you don't, it doesn't mean that, again, that you're free and clear. And then these CRISPR-based technologies, again, we've heard a lot about gene editing over the last few years, but there's also CRISPR-based diagnostics, utilizing a similar type of technology where you have an RNA guide and you have a CRISPR molecule as well. And then what happens if you interact with pieces or parts of the virus, then you end up releasing or having certain detectors that can signal that you have the virus. And we've seen progress even in the last few days with that technology. Again, a very rapid technology, one that can also evolve if the virus evolves. So I think we're all very optimistic about the potential there.
I'm going to wrap with a question we've had from one of our viewers. We've already discussed and touched on this idea of contact tracing. So a question that's come up is, how do you think about a person's individual rights to privacy when it comes to a contact tracing, say, app? Will we have to see people be forced into these types of systems? Will they all be opt-in? And then, you know, if you want to touch on testing as well, I think it's also relevant. Will testing become mandatory as people start to think about going back to work?
I think that's the reason why people are talking about contacts, again, is to make sure that those who are at highest risk have the option of being notified. And so you'll hear a difference between the concept of contact notification and actual contact tracing. A notification would be something where people could choose to be part or know if they were around someone for a significant period of time who ultimately tested positive. Public health officials continue to use contact tracing and are doing what they've been trained to do to make sure that they keep and that we keep the public safe. So you're going to see, again, this kind of these different options as we move forward.
Thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure having you today. And thanks also to Tom from BD. It's been a fascinating discussion.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation.
And my thanks as well to Chrissy, to Jessica, and Tom Poland. We obviously had a couple of technical issues there, but we are grateful for his participation, contribution, and time. Coming up, we're going to hear from a couple of more CEOs, the head of Moderna, Stéphane Bancel, and of Regeneron, Len Schleifer, and Epic, Judy Faulkner. Those among the guests that you are going to see very shortly. We want to once again thank our sponsors, Hospital for Special Surgery and Vanda Pharmaceuticals. We really literally couldn't do it without them, and we appreciate their stalwart partnership in this. Our next discussion is with the leaders of two companies that are on the forefront of trying to develop both treatments and vaccines for COVID-19. And I'm going to ask now a poll question before I introduce our guests and our interviewer. And here we go. And so we're asking you now, what is most likely to make the biggest impact in the effort to control the pandemic this year? Is it a vaccine? Is it a new drug? Is it a repurposed drug? Or could it be a cocktail of drugs? So we're going to talk about a short timeline there and which is going to be more important in treating this pandemic over the remainder of the year. And to do that and discuss that and more, let's bring in Stéphane Bancel. He is the CEO of Moderna, and Len Schleifer is the co-founder and CEO of Regeneron. And my friend and partner here today, Meg Tirell, will do the interviewing. Meg?
Hi, thank you so much. And Stéphane and Len, it's great to see you both today. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
All right. Well, I want to start where Tyler just mentioned timelines, because both of you are doing projects at timelines we have never seen before. You know, Stéphane, you just got fast track designation this morning from the FDA for your vaccine for COVID-19, which almost seems a little bit ceremonial given the speed you were already moving with this program. And Dr. Fauci mentioned in his testimony this morning, it's only been something like 62 days from when you guys envisioned this project together to now, when you're already in human clinical trials and already talking about starting your phase two. And Len, with your new drug approach with an antibody development, you already set the record in Ebola for 9 months from envisioning the project to getting into human testing. And now you aim to break that in 5 months for your antibody drug for COVID-19. So I want to ask you both, how are you doing this, shattering these timelines, even from the timelines you set at the beginning of this project? And Len, let's start with you. What are you doing differently here that's allowing you to speed this up so much?
Sure. So thanks for having us, Meg. Let me just start out by saying that what we're going to talk about here is reflective of decades of investment. People who know Regeneron and have followed us for a while knew that the first 25 years of the company, we actually lost money every single year, but we continue to invest in technology, and the technology is getting better and better and better. And we've used this technology as a way to make human antibodies. What the immune system normally does when it's faced with a virus, it makes antibodies because it wants to fight this invader. When we have an effective vaccine, hopefully Stéphane and others will bring that to the market, a vaccine tricks the body into making these antibodies. But no matter what, it takes some time and it takes some work on the body. So even on day one, you're not ready to go if you've seen a new bug. It takes a while. We can make these antibodies in our new technology. As you said, normally it takes years and years to do all this. We sped it up with Ebola. We knew that there was a big problem. And the Ebola opportunity taught us a lot of things, and we could set the land speed record of getting into patients in about 9 months. Now we hope to do it in 5 months. Our team was just entirely focused. The day that they had the sequence, they were on this new virus. They were making what they needed to make. They were putting the virus in the magical mice. We were doing things in parallel. We were taking risks. And this, I think, speaks to the fact that everybody has to understand this only happens when you have a robust biotechnology industry that is invested in technology and biology for decades.
Absolutely. Stefan, tell us a little bit about what you're doing differently here in terms of envisioning the trials even taking place on top of one another. As you get certain data from one, you're starting the next. How are you managing to compress these timelines in such an unprecedented way?
So I think it's a bit similar to what Len just said. First the technology. We have, as you know, Meg, invested for now 9 years in the technology, maybe $600-700 million just going into pure science. This is the 10th vaccine we are putting into clinical studies. So there's been a lot of learning there. We have worked with Dr. Tony Sfarchi team on the Middle East respiratory syndrome, another coronavirus, for almost 2 years now. And our manufacturing plant. When we build our manufacturing plant, a lot of people, said, this is too early, you guys are crazy. And if we had worked with contract manufacturers, we could never have moved so fast. And I think, of course, the FDA and the dialogue we've had with the FDA, which is almost literally daily, as we have questions, as we're trying together to figure out how do we move fast but safely. In everything we do, safety is extremely important. And of course, even more with vaccines, because you give vaccines to healthy people in your clinical studies, but also commercially down the road if we get there. And so safety is very important. So one of the things we've done is, as the phase two is going to start, any day now, is really to think about what is the minimum body of data we need given the risk reward to start the phase two. And what we agreed is that safety was very important to have a safety from a phase one. But in normal times, we would have waited for antibody levels, look at all the data, ask experts, and only then start to make the phase two material if success in phase one, and then recruit and start the site for phase two. So here we say, look, life's at stake. Let's make the phase two material at risk during the phase one. Let's not wait for the immunogenicity, the neutralization antibody data. Let's just go into phase two as soon as we know the safety of a phase one is positive.
And so you got the go-ahead from the FDA to start the phase two, knowing the safety from the phase one is positive. When will we get to see those phase one data?
So as soon as the NIH and ourselves feel that there is data to be shared, so as you know, the phase one study is being conducted by Dr. Tony Fauci and his team. So as soon as we have data that makes sense, we will, of course, share it. We know everybody is eager to see the data. And I would say same thing on the preclinical data. As you know, in some therapeutic area like cancer that Len and his company know very well, preclinical models are complicated to translate into human. But in infectious disease, that has been shown by many companies before us, if you get the right animal model, you can do a challenge into an animal where you vaccinate them and then you give them a very high dose of a virus and you can see, are we getting protection? And so that also preclinical work should be published pretty soon now.
I'm sure we'll be looking eagerly to see that. Len, I wonder if you can tell us just a little bit about your confidence level in your antibody approach working. When you talk to a lot of people who know the industry well, including Dr. Scott Gottlieb, who we had on earlier, he always brings up Regeneron as one of the companies he's watching to give us a new tool potentially come the fall. And you have done this, of course, for Ebola just recently using your magical mice, as you call them. So, we hear about there's only a 10% success rate in getting a new drug across the finish line when you start the development, but where would you put your probability of success in COVID-19 for your antibody approach?
That's a great question, Meg. I appreciate Dr. Gottlieb's mentioning of what we do. I have to say that we're pretty optimistic for two different reasons. The first reason is what we're trying to do is simply to imitate what nature normally does. If you think about a newborn or a baby developing in utero, that baby doesn't have a great immune system. So what does nature do? The mother sends her antibodies across the placenta so that if anything gets to the baby, that baby is protected by those antibodies. That's a passive transfer of her antibodies to the baby's antibodies. After that baby is born, the first mother's milk and subsequent to that, milk provides antibodies because the baby's immune system is really not up to snuff. So this passive transfer of antibodies is a very natural thing, and it goes on all the time, as I said, in those contexts. But it was also shown, actually the first Nobel Prize ever awarded for medicine or physiology was for immunology, where von Behring had discovered that if you took people who were already exposed to diphtheria, they had an antibody that could be given to other people and it could help them recover from diphtheria. So the concept of passive transfer is something we're just trying to imitate, so it gives us great optimism. Now, the second factor is, can we actually get good antibodies, and does our technology deliver this same type of passive transfer? Well, we've been making half a dozen or more drugs with these mice. We know how to make the antibodies, and the most relevant antibodies we've made is a cocktail for Ebola, where we actually showed you could save lives in a study that was done in the Congo. And it was a study that was done, really importantly, not an observational study, not a case control study, but a study that was done based upon randomized, controlled, well-controlled data. And that's the kind of data that gives you confidence. And when we saw that data, that study was stopped early because the data were overwhelmingly positive. In fact, in that study was remdesivir, and remdesivir really didn't perform all that well relative to our antibody cocktail. So we have a lot of confidence that we can make the right antibodies, we can select the right antibodies, we know how to scale them up, that's going on, and all we're doing is imitating what's known to work, giving antibodies like a mother gives a baby, like people have transferred plasma to people. This is not breakthrough conceptually, it's breakthrough technologically.
Absolutely. And I was actually just reading about that diphtheria example in The Great Influenza, that amazing book by John Barry about the 1918 flu. It's a great read for anybody who hasn't read it. We've got a viewer question I want to bring to you guys from Gunner. He asks, what is the industry doing to partner with hospitals or clinical researchers to enroll these trials so quickly? Part of setting that land speed record, as Len put it, is reliant on getting study drug to patients. How are you both doing this? And maybe we'll start with Stefan.
Yeah, so indeed, to achieve this type of timelines, it's about preparing early and extraordinary collaboration. And so we talk to hospitals, you know, that we're working with, you know, way ahead of a study. So if you again look back at our phase two, that's going to start soon, for which we got the green light last week. We have been talking about it to the sites and the investigator for quite some time. My team is actually spending most of the time now preparing the phase three that we say could start in early summer. And so you want to be ahead of the game. You want to really engage, get them engaged in the protocol design, get their input so that you get the best outcome as quickly as you can.
Yeah, Stefan's right. Engaging the investigators is really critical. But I'll say this, there's two factors. We've been at this for a long time. There's two factors in play always, always, always. One is there an unmet medical need? Obviously, there's a huge unmet medical need here. And two is there promise or belief that your approach might work? We, unfortunately, located in New York, we were in the epicenter of this pandemic in Westchester County, where our company was located. I'm happy to say we had very few cases at the company itself, but there were so many patients, and I must say, Governor Cuomo did a fabulous job of letting the public know we were teetering on overwhelming the system. At any rate, because the system had so many patients, sometimes in clinical trials, you're lucky to enroll a couple of patients a week. That would be a lot sometimes. We enrolled in the height of all this for our earlier trials with Kevzara, over 100 patients in a single day. So I have to say that the combination of need, which is overwhelming, and promise, which I think people are able to assess, is what drives enrollment.
Well, I want to ask you a question about that, because one of the things we've observed before with drugs or vaccines developed for outbreaks is that the science is not fast enough to keep up with the infection. And often what happens is, we saw this early on with Ebola, we saw this with Zika, we saw this with SARS, and to some extent with MERS, that while there were projects underway, the infections burned themselves out before the drugs or vaccines could be tested in areas where there was a lot of active infection. One potential solution to that, and also to get results faster, that's been brought up by some respected epidemiologists, infectious disease experts, and bioethicists, is what's known as human challenge trials. The idea that you would actually give the virus to volunteers, to healthy volunteers, to test how well typically a vaccine works. This is something that we've never really talked about before in medicine in the United States. I wonder about both of your thoughts about this idea. And Stefan, since you're developing a vaccine that is one of the furthest along, has the idea of human challenge trials come up?
Yes, so we have been discussing it with the team and our advisors. There has been challenge done before, for example, for RSV, there's been challenge done. And one of the key criteria from an ethical standpoint is, do you have medicines in case the vaccine will not work? To be able, of course, to ensure people don't get disease or severe disease, or of course, in that case, with SARS-CoV-2, you know, death. And so we want to be part of a dialogue. There's a lot of consideration, obviously, from an ethical standpoint, which is priority number one. I know there are several groups in several universities, and I think the NIH as well is working on trying to write white papers and have the right expert around the table. I think, for example, if, you know, Regeneron drugs were to show positive outcome in the clinic, which we are all optimistic about, having such a tool will be a great component of how do you design such a study. But in the case of Moderna, what I think might be interesting, because you need to also figure out what's the dose of a virus you're going to give. You need to have a GMP setup of a virus, because it has to be well controlled, so you understand your study. If you think about it, I mean, we are aiming at starting our placebo control, randomized, you know, pivotal study, phase three, in early summer. And if we do it large enough, which we believe we should be able to do because of a great sponsorship we had from BARDA, where we basically got, you know, $483 million to run a very, very large study, because we don't know where the attack rate is going to be in early fall. But if you think about it, if we're able to run, you know, thousands and thousands of healthy subjects getting vaccinated, and then into the potentially, you know, second wave in the fall, we should be able to get efficacy readout actually pretty quickly, maybe even faster than getting a challenge study set up properly without having all the ethical considerations. So we want to be part of a dialogue. We're open to any group that is conducting such a study, but we might be able to go as fast, if not faster, just by running a plain efficacy study because we are so close to doing so.
Len, what are your thoughts on the concept of that?
Yeah, it's a great question, but let's frame the problem so we can understand whether the solution fits. What is the problem? If you're doing a preventive trial like we would like to do with our cocktail or Stefan will do with a vaccine, you're relying on what is the background rate of people getting infected without your drug. If you put 5,000 people in a trial and you had a background rate of infection over the course of 3 months or something of 1%, you'd have only 50 people perhaps that became positive in the placebo group. That's if you had 5,000 people in that placebo group. So you might have to have another 5,000 to show that you prevented half of those people or something, because you want to go from 50 to 25, you know, you need a lot of people. So that's the problem. That's the nub of the problem you're getting at. That is, when you're trying to do prevention, you're relying on the natural disease frequency. Now, if the frequency is high, you're going into a nursing home or something like that, or first responders or healthcare workers, maybe you can do those types of studies, family members and so on. What the challenge study is trying to think about is, can we change the numbers? So instead of having to study 10,000 people, you might be able to study 100 people. Think how much quicker you could get that done. Now, what are the challenges, if you will, of a challenge study? It's really the challenge of the unknown. We do know, for example, that people who are young, who might be a good volunteers for this, that is people from 20 to 30, have a very low rate of very serious disease. But we learn a lot about this virus every day. And we learn that there are late sequelae. We're now even seeing in children this Kawasaki-like syndrome. So I think one has to have an ethical perspective that cannot be put forth by people like Stefan and myself, the people who are highly conflicted, because we obviously want to go forward. We want to do this fast. We want to get results. And that creates our conflict. We can only lay out what we know, and it will be up to independent ethical groups, perhaps the NIH, university scholars in this field, to weigh in. I'm sure there will be no shortage of people willing to volunteer. The question is not whether people would volunteer to do this. The question is whether how the ethics come out. And we have to leave that up to the ethicists after providing them the information.
Really great points. And I have to get to some more viewer questions because we're getting so many good ones. I'm going to stick on the subject of ethics a little bit. And this one really is about access. Once your products get developed, which we hope that they will and they'll be successful, one person asks, can you discuss how access programs for new vaccines or treatments for COVID-19 might be designed? Daniel O'Day, Gilead CEO, of course, has said remdesivir will be accessible, but details are scant. And of course, as we're watching that rollout in the US, we're seeing that it's not getting everywhere. It potentially needs to go and there might not be enough. Do you have any thoughts or ideas on how these kinds of access programs might be designed, Stefan?
Sure. So what is clear, and I'm talking about the vaccine, is that we at the global level are not going to have enough supply. As I've said before on your show, I'm really rooting for every vaccine manufacturers because I really hope that all the other programs get to the finish line. Of course, as we know, the odds that every program works are really low, obviously. But I really hope that we have, you know, 3, 4, 5 vaccines, because no manufacturers can make enough doses for the planet. And so what is going to happen, I believe, and we are starting to have discussions with, for example, the US government about it, which is, how do we provide access? How do you prioritize? And we believe this is not a company decision. This has been done by the clinical community, being coordinated across the country. And so we're going to continue to work very closely, as we have done before, with, you know, NIAID and Dr. Fauci's team, you know, with the CDC, to figure out what's the best plan for access within the country. And what we'll make sure is that every time we make a new lot of product and it's approved by quality control and we think it's a good lot, we will, of course, make it available and be basically hand to mouth. I can anticipate that as different vaccines potentially get to approval, we're going to be for at least a year and a half, really with a tight, tight supply across the country and across the world.
Mm. And Len, I'll give the last word to you, as I can't believe we're almost out of time already. Given what you've observed so far of how the system has worked for distributing remdesivir, and it is early days, are you confident that if the United States government is helping with the coordination of distribution of your medicine, it will be done in the most equitable way?
Yeah, look, any medicine that we come up with that can make a difference has to be both accessible and affordable. And the problem is not just within the country. Obviously, we think country first, but it really will be a global problem. And it'll be a question of, sometimes it'll be a question of whether or not there's even a distribution capability in some of low income countries around the globe, for example, if it requires a cold chain, something simple as that. So I think that we have some challenges. We have the distribution capability to give out drugs, whether you go to your local CVS or you go to your doctor, you can get a vaccine, you can get a subcutaneous shot, you can get an infusion in the hospital. The distribution aspect in the United States, the physical distribution, I think is more than adequate. I do think that there will be a capacity issue. And like Stefan, we're not the only people who are trying to make an antibody cocktail. There are a lot of other good, fine companies that are working on this. I know Lilly's at it, and there are others. And we need multiple successes because the demand will far exceed the capacity. We simply cannot do this on a auction basis, whatever state or local area or company wants to pay the highest amount to get access. We can't do it that way. We're going to need some rational approach. And this is when we're in these types of emergencies, this is a role for governments, federal governments, governments around in the United States, governments around the world, state governments. We have to make sure this is done equitable and does the greatest amount of good.
All right. Well, Len and Stefan, we'll eagerly await more updates on your programs. Thank you both for being here with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Meg.
All right, Tyler, sending it back to you.
Thank you very much, Meg. And my thanks as well to Stefan and Len. And I was very pleased to see that in Len's shot, there was a diploma from my alma mater, the University of Virginia. So we appreciate that. And you'll be able to rejoin Meg in just a moment. We do later on today have a rare interview with Pfizer's Albert Bourla. So you'll want to stay around for that. He is the chairman and CEO of that company, which is making great strides in the battle against coronavirus.
There's two powerful words in business, yes and no.
The Keynote is a new podcast from the CNBC events team featuring in-depth conversations with CEOs, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders, recorded live from the main stage at CNBC's event series. Take a front row seat for interviews with the biggest names in business. Hear candid comments about successes and challenges.
If you're not open, if you're not willing to learn, if you're not willing to fail, and we're failing at some things, you're going to go away.
Lessons on leadership and managing through a crisis.
The first job of a CEO is stare down the brutal facts and get people to embrace the brutal facts.
And the untold stories behind fascinating businesses.
I think of myself as a creative person who has entrepreneurial DNA.
Subscribe to The Keynote wherever you get your podcasts.
At CNBC Events, we're bringing you the power of our newsroom wherever you are.
This is going to be a presentation you will not forget.
With an ever-growing lineup of exclusive summits, CNBC Events delivers some of the biggest names in business and adapts to a new and ever-changing world.
Welcome to this virtual event from CNBC.
With heavy hitters and innovative leaders in tech, finance, healthcare, and more, CNBC Events brings you rare insights and smart opportunities.
This is an industry and a business and a job where there is very few areas that don't affect you.
You were explaining why now is the time to be the risk off or a little more cautious.
I think you want to be cautious, right? I mean, I think you look at the world and you say, what do we know?
Addressing the crisis of today and the lasting economic impacts of tomorrow.
Your only choice is to adapt and change.
You always gotta like focus on something that could be improved in the fairly near term because patients need solutions now.
CNBC Events, up close and personal with dynamic virtual technology, one-on-one interaction with business leaders, plus sponsorship and networking opportunities in a totally immersive environment.
We are all trying to figure out what the new version of work-life balance is.
CNBC Events delivers with multi-platform coverage, both in-person and virtual, from live streaming, podcasts, and social media to the power of CNBC on air.
Are we seeing the future? Are we living it right now?
Visit CNBCEvents.com to learn more and join us.
And welcome back, everybody. Welcome if you're just joining us for the first time here at Healthy Returns, our annual healthcare summit. We took a little longer there than anticipated because we were having a little bit of technical issue that we're trying to resolve. And we'll get back to Judy Faulkner of Epic once we do work out those issues. We're delighted you could join us today. We're going to hear from a variety of other healthcare executives, including Pfizer's Albert Bourla, in just 1 minute. You can connect with us on social. You can tweet us at CNBC Events and also use the hashtag Healthy Returns. Let's move now to our discussion with Albert Bourla of Pfizer. He took over about a year and a half ago and has been on the forefront of developing a company that he says goes back to its innovative roots. He spoke yesterday with our Meg Tirell.
Well, Albert, thank you so much for joining us today in what is a weird way for us to be meeting. The last time we saw each other was at the JP Morgan Healthcare Conference, and we'd hoped to be able to be doing this in person, but it's great to see you virtually.
It's great to see you virtually as well, Meg.
So I want to sort of set the stage for folks about where you're coming from as Pfizer CEO. You were with the company for two decades before you became the chairman and CEO at the beginning of last year. And already in the first year that you were CEO, you were taking steps to really transform the company, making a big acquisition of a cancer drug maker for more than $10 billion, spinning off and creating a joint venture of your consumer healthcare group with GlaxoSmithKline, and of course, merging your off-patents drug business with Mylan. But then, of course, this year came COVID-19. And in my 10 years of covering the drug industry, I've never seen anything like this in terms of the speed and the sheer volume of the efforts from the drug industry focused on one problem. Tell us about those early days of decision-making at Pfizer about whether to get involved with COVID-19 and how. What was that like?
Look, it is like a great privilege, but at the same time, it's a great responsibility, and you feel it in your shoulders. And when you know that you have the capabilities, particularly a company with the size of Pfizer that has end-to-end from early research all the way to manufacturing and distribution capabilities, and you know that you have the science and you trust this technology, but you know that you need to deliver. And you know that your success or failure would mean human lives and a great impact in the global economy. So if you are the CEO and you have to make these decisions, that feels very heavy on your shoulders, Meg.
I'm sure. So you sort of went in stages in terms of, you know, jumping in as a company. You laid out a 5-point plan to get involved. You started looking through Pfizer's existing assets. And then, of course, you forged this partnership with BioNTech to develop a vaccine using an entirely new technology. Tell us about the decision-making that went into forging that partnership and choosing that technology to pursue this vaccine.
Yes, with BioNTech, we have a great collaboration for the last 2 years and in the same technology. We were not working together to develop a COVID, of course, vaccine the last 2 years, but we were working together to develop a flu vaccine. And the reason is because, as you know, in flu, you have different strains every year. And we believe that this technology, because has tremendous speed in the way that you can go from a new strain all the way to manufacturing a vaccine, it would be ideal and could disrupt, actually, the flu market. Now, immediately, when we realized that COVID-19 is about to become pandemic and the size of this disease, we immediately jumped into it and we thought, what can we offer as Pfizer? And we looked at the vaccines, we looked at the therapies of new molecules, antivirals, and also we looked therapies from our existing portfolio. So BioNTech was the first one that came to mind because the technology is ideal for something like that. So immediately we jumped into this with BioNTech. You have to know that we moved with the speed of light. And actually, this is the name of our project. And we did that without even having a contract, both parties. We just agreed that that needs to be done. The world is waiting. Before signing a contract, they started sharing their strengths and we started making investments. And then eventually we signed a letter of intent. And then only after we were already well into this collaboration, eventually signed a contract between the two of us. And I hope that that will work and bring a solution.
Well, tell us about these kinds of timelines that we're talking about. When will we see the first data potentially? You've already started human clinical trials in both Germany and the United States.
Yes. First of all, the unique thing with our approach is not that it is mRNA, which there is another one that I hope also will be successful because we need options. The unique approach is that we are testing 4 different vaccines. And those 4 different vaccines are combinations of 2 different antigens. One, it is the spike, and one, it is the what we call the RBD, which is the tip of the spike, and 3 different platforms. And we started already all vaccinations, all programs. They are going to go both in the US and in Europe. We are collecting data as we speak, real time. So we know we are monitoring the safety of the doses. We are moving very fast into higher doses because the first ones worked well. We are going to start having immunogenicity data as we speak, but I think conclusive data as to which one of the four could be the winner, if any would be the winner, we will have around June, July. And from then we will scale up, let's say in July or end of July, into one or two of the winners into much bigger trials. And then eventually we will come to September where we could launch a much broader study of thousands of people. I think that at the same time it's critical that we start manufacturing, because if we don't start manufacturing and we wait to see if any of the vaccines work, then we will not have time. We will not have doses available for the fall that we believe will be crucial. So if things go well, and if we feel that the product is safe and efficacious, and if FDA and EMA feel, and other regulatory agencies, the same, we will be able to deliver millions of doses in the October timeframe. And then we are scaling up manufacturing to be able to deliver hundreds of millions in 2021.
Well, I want to ask you about that manufacturing capacity. Reuters had a story on Friday saying that Pfizer was looking at outsourcing some of its other manufacturing to more of your manufacturing partners to try to essentially clear capacity for the vaccine manufacturing. Can you talk us through what kinds of efforts are already underway to be able to do this at such large scale so quickly?
Yes, obviously, Meg, when you want to manufacture hundreds of millions of doses in a network that is already very busy, you will have to do a few things, right? And there are multiple things that we are doing right now, from ordering raw materials that will be needed to something like that, and making commitments to those third-party manufacturers to develop them. Also, trying to change the production lines and reorganize our current manufacturing so that we can create capacity. And as part of that, we may transfer to other manufacturers some of our current manufacturing that is making in-house, but it is much more simpler, so that we will be able to focus our efforts in manufacturing the potential vaccine.
Well, I know that Pfizer also makes, through its Hospira unit, many of these, you know, essential drugs for critically ill patients, what are known as sterile injectables. And some of these, because of COVID-19, but also because of manufacturing issues that Hospira has been dealing with for years since before Pfizer acquired it, are in shortage. And I was just talking with a specialist, Aaron Fox at Utah, about some of the drugs she's concerned about, like fentanyl, midazolam, propofol, rocuronium. These are drugs that are needed to support patients on ventilation with COVID-19. As we're facing so many patients still in hospitals in the ICU and a potential second wave in the fall, how is Pfizer making sure that you can manufacture enough of those drugs as you undertake this huge challenge of simultaneously trying to manufacture this vaccine at such large scale?
Yes, Meg, from day one, we try to set our priorities. And of course, like everybody else's, our first priority was the safety of our people. But we understood that we have also an additional role to play, which is the safety of the society. So in addition to the safety of our people, we set a second and third goal, making sure that we maintain the supply of our medicines to those that they need them, and with an emphasis on products that we thought will be in high demand in ICUs or other hospital units that are related with COVID-19. And the third priority was to make sure that we develop a research solution. We spoke a little bit about the vaccine, but when it comes to maintaining the supply chain, I need to tell you that we have one of the most sophisticated and complicated manufacturing network in the world. And none of our manufacturing sites became non-operational during the crisis. We were able to maintain all sites operational. And we had created from day one a list of what we thought would be 77 medicines that we manufacture and will be in critical supply from the hospitals. And we built proactively plans to build up incremental stocks, and also to do what you were describing with the vaccine, to move shift production so that we can create space to manufacture more of them. And I think we did very well so far, and I plan, we are fully committed to maintain this level of rigor so that we will be able to supply all medicines that are needed by whoever is needed.
We're still hearing about these shortages of drugs and products made for emergency use in hospitals, you know, from Hospira, things as simple as sugar water, dextrose, or epinephrine. Where are you, would you say, on fixing those problems from Hospira and alleviating these shortages that we've been observing for years?
Yeah, you're right that in the previous years, we saw a few shortages from the Hospira manufacturing site. And during those 2 years that we acquired the Hospira manufacturing sites, we have invested billions of dollars to modernize those facilities and to continue doing that. And we have tangible progress in the number of shortages that we are experiencing right now. And particularly, as I said, with the 77 medicines, they were very sporadic, but in general, we're able to supply those that they need them.
One of the things that Pfizer put out in your five-point plan originally to help with COVID-19 was to use your manufacturing capacity to help others manufacture drugs or vaccines if they were approved. Of course, you're trying to do so much yourself at Pfizer, but now we're seeing that remdesivir, Gilead's drug, has been cleared through the emergency use authorization pathway, and there doesn't seem to be enough of it to go around. Is Pfizer thinking or looking into whether it can help there?
Absolutely. I don't want to disclose specific discussions that are between us and Gilead, but I need to tell you that since we issued those five points plan, more than 350 different companies have reached out to Pfizer asking our support. And the support could be from manufacturing, as you mentioned, or to utilization of some of our intellectual property or some of our tests or some of our knowledge or sometimes capital. And we are the most promising of them. We are providing any support we can. This is not business as usual, Meg, and there are two competitors ahead of us right now, the virus and time. Nobody else is competitor.
With that in mind, this not being business as usual, you know, one of the things that Gilead is encountering now are questions from both the patient advocacy community and then also from Wall Street about where they're going to be pricing remdesivir. How do you think at this early stage, granted, but you're thinking about, you know, later this year, potentially this vaccine being available potentially in some form or fashion, how do you think about pricing these things right now?
Yes, I didn't even think about it. And we have never so far built any sales projections about any of the projects that we are doing for COVID-19, because this is not what is important right now. From day one, what I said to our people was that we need to think beyond return on investment. It's not a variable at all. All we need to think it is return on effort. If we could, by placing the effort, make a difference. So in the vaccine, for example, we thought we can, and we jumped into it. We have no idea if we'll be successful. Now we have a very, very good chance because of the reasons that I just explained. So once the product is available, I think we will discuss with our partner BioNTech how we are going to commercialize it. But this is one thing is for certain. One, there will be no American or that cannot get it or European that cannot get it when it is available, and because of price. That will be clearly the guideline.
And, you know, in the little time we have left, I wonder, how is this experience, do you think, changing the drug industry, how you all work together, and how is it, if it is, changing Pfizer? Will we be seeing a different version of the company coming out of this?
Look, as you said before, let me start with the industry. That I'm very proud with the way that the industry has responding. I'm very proud with the way that all my peers, companies, and CEOs, they are working together with academia, with smaller biotechs to make sure that we deliver a solution. Now, when it comes to Pfizer, as you had said before, Pfizer is transforming. And the last 1 year, likely we are going through one of the largest transformation in such short period of time since the establishment of the company 171 years back. But this is not happening because I came on board. This is only happening because the last decade, under the leadership of the previous CEO, Ian Reed, that I was part of his leadership team, and Michael Dolsten, who is currently the head of R&D and used to be the head of R&D, we have an effort to revitalize our innovative core, to build a new scientific machine out of Pfizer, and also to make sure that we make the company nimble and ready to work. In 2016, for example, when I was running the innovative business in Pfizer, I divided the whole business into six units that they are operating like six small biotechs. It is the oncology biotech, the vaccines biotech, and as Pfizer, we are just allocating resources and appointing the right people to lead those units. The COVID-19 for me is not that it's transforming Pfizer, but first of all, is making a great test to our capabilities. I don't think that the world was expecting from a gigantic company like Pfizer, with that scale, to be able to move so fast and jump into the phase one clinical trial at the same time that it's manufacturing for a vaccine, just in weeks. And that's, again, a new way of operating within Pfizer. When it comes to reputation now, and I want to close with that, yes, I hope that this crisis could reset the perception about the value proposition that the industry is bringing to society. Look, Meg, last year, Pfizer treated with our medicines almost 500 million people. We touched the lives of 500 million families. How many fathers or mothers with cancer, for example, will live long enough to see the graduation of the daughter or the wedding of the son because of us? There is no other industry that can claim that is bringing to humanity so much good. But the reputation was very bad. I think now it's a great opportunity to be able to set it where it should be. I know that reputation is earned in drops, but you can lose it in buckets. And I hope that we will earn it drop after drop. I don't want to declare any victory, but I think people right now across the globe, billions of people, hundreds of businesses, actually millions of businesses and hundreds of governments are investing their hope for a solution to the pharma industry. That should mean something.
Well, Albert Bourla, we appreciate you being here with us today, and we'll be watching and eagerly awaiting updates on your efforts in COVID-19 and everything else. Thanks again.
Thank you very much, Meg.
Grateful to both of them for their time and insights today. Our next guest is one of the leading women in all of healthcare. Judy Faulkner co-founded and is the CEO of Epic Systems, a software company that is in practically every hospital, clinic, doctor's office, one way or another across the country. And as such, it has unique insights into the immense amount of data that are generated through the healthcare system every single day, and probably some insights on what we can learn about treating and developing new therapies for COVID. Let's find out with Bertha Coombs and Judy Faulkner. Take it away, Bertha.
Thanks very much, Tyler and Judy. Thank you so much for joining us. You know, were in the forefront of digital health, and I've got to imagine over the last couple of months, things have just fast-tracked incredibly, from building field hospitals for New York health systems with hundreds of beds, complete with their Epic charts, to helping some of these same frontline clinicians track and predict what is going to be happening with their patients. Tell us about what some of that process has been like, particularly when you developed the deterioration index.
Okay, you've covered a bunch of things. Thank you, Bertha. Good to see you. Well, we've been, as you said, really, really busy, and it's been interesting. I think of our health systems as heroes. They are the heroes. And we see our job as being heroes helping heroes, and we're proud to be that. Some of the things we've done, telehealth has been a big one. It's been interesting. On the average, our customers have increased telehealth by about 100-fold. But some of our customers have said they've gone from 20 telehealth visits a day to 8,000. That's huge. We installed over 200 health systems, and we trained 5,000 people in telehealth. We've got a COVID-19 dashboard that I'm told is used a lot. It is something that keeps test metrics and capacity so that the executives of the organization know what is happening with COVID. We've, as you mentioned, extended beds. Normally it takes months to get a EHR system into an organization, and we were told to do it in 3 days. And so, you know, after thinking that's impossible, we had to figure out how to do it in 3 days. And that's what we've been doing, as you mentioned, in New York, in McCormick Place in Chicago, and in other areas as well. We've also developed a portal with Cleveland Clinic that we call Care Companion, and that allows our health systems to send patients home with the software on the portal so that the software itself helps educate the patient, helps direct the patient as what to do, and alerts the health system if the health system needs to step in.
Worked on is a way for clinicians to share what they've seen, and that helped you develop the deterioration index. Can you talk to us about that?
I missed the first words of what you just said. What were the first words?
You developed a deterioration index that helps predict which patients are going to become more sick.
Yes, we did. That's called the deterioration index. And what happens is that when patients have a lot going on, they've got machines tied to them all over. Those machines are spewing out tons of data, and the human mind can't process that as quickly as electronic systems can do that. So our systems then evaluate that data, and we can alert the clinicians hours ahead of time, which can be life-saving in many cases, to the fact that the patient is rapidly deteriorating. We've been testing this in over 100 health systems now. Feedback is that it works well.
You've also been working with a number of health systems on monitoring and taking a look at which drugs do and don't work well, because oftentimes patients are already on certain drugs, including hydroxychloroquine, which has been talked a lot about, and you've helped them figure out whether these might help in prevention and might help in treatment. How difficult was it to get that happening in real time?
Everything we've been working on seems to take a lot of time to do it, and it's not easy either. That's part of the trick of it, getting people to analyze the data. Some cases we're looking at over 100 million patients and trying to figure out what is going on with all of them. For the medications that we looked at about 30 medications to see if any of them were going to be protective of patients if they were taken before the patients were exposed to COVID. And what we found, unfortunately, was none of them seemed to be protective. We're also looking at what meds seem to work best after the patient does get COVID, and that's coming up in the future, along with some other things. We're looking at plasma therapy, at remdesivir. One of the really interesting things that we're doing now is, can you get it twice? We're looking at patients who had COVID, then got better, then did they have COVID again? Because clearly we want to see whether your antibodies are protective.
You know, it's one of those things that, you know, I often talk to insurers, and I don't know anyone who loves their health insurer. When I talk to hospital administrators, they all really have great things to say about your system. But then when you talk to the clinicians, they get frustrated, not just with your electronic records, but with all of them, because it's just unwieldy for them. And I would imagine, especially, I mean, I've seen some of this, the social media, especially in the middle of a crisis, it becomes unwieldy. Have you looked at things to make it easier for these clinicians to use them? And has watching this pandemic evolve made you think about changes to the electronic records to make them easier to use?
Yeah, a few things. We've constantly been looking at how do you make the system easier to use. That's one thing that we have multiple people every day working on that, and we have for years. It's kind of interesting. I remember once being at a dinner, and a man came up to me who is one of our physicians, and he said, "Why couldn't you make the system more like paper? It should have a spiral around the side of it. It should have tabs just like paper." And then that same day, another person came up to me and said, "Why does the system look so much like paper? This is an electronic world. It needs to forget about paper and be creative." And so it's a challenge, and every physician uses the system differently than every other physician. But your question was, do we work on it? We work on it a ton. It's an important thing to do. And you always have the challenge of ease of use versus power. It needs to do all these things, but at the same time, it needs to be easy to use. And how do you do that?
One of the issues that people bring up is the issue of interoperability, particularly right now when we have a public health crisis. It would be nice if this data was able to flow across systems more organically and more easily. You've been seen as someone who has opposed the government's efforts to bring about interoperability. Have you rethought it during this pandemic as you look at clinicians trying to share data and trying to find the signal in all the noise?
We were actually the originators of interoperability. That was in the early 2000s. And it was because my husband, who's a physician, had a patient who was under good care, but she went with her family to another city. She got sick. She went to the emergency department and she died. And he kept saying, if they had had her record, they would have known what to do. It was easy. So I went to HIMSS board, which is the trade association for EHR vendors and for health system vendors in general. And I asked them when there was going to be standardization of data so that we can interoperate. And their answer was pretty much, don't hold your breath. So we decided we could at least interoperate with those systems that we could manage, which were our Epic systems. And we created interoperability for all the Epic users. And we went to every single Epic site and we put the interoperability in and we retrofitted the software so that no matter what version of our software they had, the interoperability worked. So then later on, interoperability became a meaningful use standard, and we follow that standard. Not every vendor has done the same thing. Some of them haven't gone out and made sure that all their health system users are up to date with it and can do it. So it's very hard that it's like a fax machine. You can't send a fax to someone who doesn't have a fax machine, so you can't interoperate with someone who doesn't interoperate. Well, we got frustrated with not being able to interoperate with a health system that couldn't interoperate. So we said, let's stop thinking of that as an excuse. They can interoperate and figure out what we can do to make it them interoperate. And so we created something called Share Everywhere, which basically injects a web viewer into the computer of whoever the patient is seeing who can't interoperate, and that allows them to interoperate with the Epic system that the patient came from. What that allows now is that the patients can be interoperable with any place in the world that has internet capability.
We've got a question from one of our viewers who says, you know, in your opinion, how should AI and clinician learning work ideally? You know, right now, we need not machine learning that's slow. We need it to be fast. Can we do it?
How should AI and clinician teaming work ideally? AI has been around from the very beginning. From the very beginning, computers tried to be more than just an electronic device for storing your words. It tried to be a helper looking up things and telling you, giving you advice as to what to do. And that has continued on. It's been embedded in every EHR system that I'm aware of. How do they team together, the physicians and the AI? I think the more that we can help the physicians learn what the AI does, and the more that the physicians can help learn what the AI does, the better it's going to work together.
Things that you're looking at is a predictive analysis right now. And I wonder, as we look toward next fall, if we've gotten through this first wave of COVID, we could see a second wave coming, just as we have the flu coming as well. How can we provide clinicians with some predictive tools to be able to differentiate and figure out which is influenza-like illness and which is actually COVID?
I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised if some of our staff know, but I don't know.
Is that one of the things that you're looking at to try to give them the tools for this next phase of the pandemic?
That's another thing I don't know. I know some of the things we're looking at, because what we're really trying to focus on is what can prevent getting COVID, what can save your life if you do get COVID. Those are the two things we're focused on right now. I think what you're asking makes a ton of sense, but I am not aware that it's something we're working on right now.
All right. And another viewer question, I'm going to put on my glasses so I can give it correctly. Is the Epic system interoperable with all the NCPDP communication standards?
We are interoperative with every standard that I know that we should be interoperative with. But I don't know the list of every standard, so I can't say yes or no.
I know that you all are interoperable and are able to export data via FHIR, so that, for example, if I have a hospital record, it can go to my iPhone and I can take that record with me. Are there any protocols you think we need to think about, particularly in the pandemic? There's been so much discussion about being able to track and trace, but eventually also being able potentially to sort of say, look, I've been tested and I know I have antibodies. Is that something that Epic can help with, to help public health systems develop a way to be able to say, hey, I'm clear?
Yes, we're working with a group that is doing that, putting a marker on the phone that will say whether you are tested and you're clear, whether you are currently not safe, whether you have COVID right now, or whether, so that would be red for if you have COVID now, it would be green if you're clear, and it would be yellow if it's unknown. And we're working with a group that's doing that. And we said to them, we'd like to do it for all our MyChart patients as well. So we're putting that on MyChart as well, so that they too will have that. And you could go into a restaurant, show your signal to the people in the restaurant, and they'll know you're clear.
And within MyChart, then it would be HIPAA compliant. That's one of the issues that you have raised with interoperability, allowing third parties that aren't in healthcare that wouldn't necessarily have to adhere to the same rules as healthcare vendors.
That is correct. The healthcare vendors are HIPAA compliant. Other third parties don't have to be. And that becomes the choice of the individual, whether they want to extend their data to those or whether they don't.
So we have another question which follows on this, and you sort of answered a little bit, but will it go any further? Would you go further and have COVID-19 tracking and tracing be folded into Epic's mobile platform?
There was a poll done recently in one of the healthcare blogs, and about two-thirds of the people said they wouldn't want that done, and one-third said they would. So we are watching the contact tracing and what people think of it to see about it. But right now, our feeling is that with so many people feeling it isn't the right thing to do, that it becomes too invasive. Right now, we are not going forward with that.
You know, you've talked a lot about privacy, particularly when it comes to your healthcare records. We are entering an era where people may have to prove that they've been tested in order to go back to work, and maybe eventually actually prove that they take a vaccine. Do you have worries about what this means in terms of our healthcare records being maintained private?
I'm not worried about the healthcare records that way. I think that, in fact, you're right that at some point, until there is, if such a thing exists, a herd immunity, that we will have to be careful watching. And people have to take responsibility for that themselves, too, that if they are ill, they should not be out. There's a lot going on that, and we're trying to help on that, too. That's the reason that some of the things that are being done, the telehealth, the care companion, are all there trying to help with that.
Judy Faulkner, thank you so much for joining us for Healthy Returns this year, and we hope you will come back in future
years. Okay, thank you, Bertha. It's an interesting time.
Certainly is. Tyler?
All right, Bertha and Ms. Faulkner, thank you very much for your participation today. Before we move to our final segment of the afternoon, an interview I know you will enjoy greatly with a couple of really big players in the healthcare, including former head of the CDC, a lot of focus has been paid to the people who are on the front lines in the battle against COVID. Let's meet two of them, one of whom had a very personal experience with his own health and had a novel way to treat it. Take a look.
Hi, my name is David Fagenbaum. I am a physician scientist at the University of Pennsylvania, where I lead a center focused on Castleman disease and other cytokine storm disorders. I was myself diagnosed with Castleman disease, a cytokine storm disorder, while I was a third-year medical student training to become an oncologist. Out of nowhere, I went from being totally healthy to experiencing multi-organ failure. My liver, my kidneys, my bone marrow, my heart and lungs all began to shut down for an unknown cause. I'm alive today. I'm speaking to you today because of a drug, sirolimus, that had never been used before for Castleman disease, that from my research, I identified as potentially being active against my disease. I nearly died. It was the fourth time when I decided I would dedicate the rest of my life, however long that may be, to trying to identify a treatment and a cure. There are a number of similarities between COVID-19 and Castleman disease. About 2 months ago, I found myself hoping and praying that some researcher somewhere would follow the approach that we've taken in the fight against Castleman disease and apply it to COVID-19. And then I stopped myself. I said, if I'm gonna hope and pray that some researcher somewhere does this, and we've done this before for Castleman disease, and we study cytokine storms all day, every day, then we need to take it upon ourselves. Our goal through the Corona Project is to identify a drug that already exists, that's FDA approved for something else, because we don't have time to wait for a new drug to be developed. I didn't regret anything I did or anything I said when I laid on my deathbed for the first time. The things I regretted were the things that I didn't do. So I left the hospital with a very simple motto: think it, do it. If I think of something and it's the right thing to do, then I want to do everything in my power to make that happen. It really takes a team effort to take down diseases like this, and it's going to require all of us working together to try to take down COVID-19.
My name is Dana Foley. I am an ICU float nurse here at Tufts Medical Center, but I am currently working on North 6, which is our newest COVID ICU. My mental health, along with, as I'm sure many of the other healthcare workers that I'm working with can attest to, has definitely been compromised during all of this. A lot of times at work, you don't really feel that you're under stress or you're just sort of doing your job. But it's when you get home that you realize your body is tired and your mind is tired and you can't really do the things that you want to do because you're physically and mentally exhausted. When people do pass, it has been something that's been very difficult for all of us. Unfortunately, there are circumstances where people's families can't come in, and we are the only people that they have to be with them in their final moments. That's been something that's been extremely difficult for us. We spend all of our time with these people in the room as often as we can be with them, and to see them do poorly, and not only do poorly, but not have their family with them is devastating. And the whole unit feels it. That definitely leaves you with a little bit of a hole where you feel like, well, what could I have done to make this not happen? Should I have made that change? And it leaves you with a lot of self-doubt. Dealing with the emotions as they come is an important part for me of maintaining my balance in my personal life and my professional life. If I push those things to the side, a lot of times they'll just sort of blow up later. When someone's released from the ICU, it is the best feeling in the world. We all line up down the hall into the hallway outside of the unit, and we've tried to make a habit of clapping people out of the unit and really, really celebrate when they have those successes. Even if you're having a really hard day, your own personal day is like really not that great, it makes your day a little bit better.
Good, as always, to remember that more people recover from this illness than those who succumb from it, which is not to minimize the pain and distress that those we have lost and the families of those people have suffered. As we move now to our final discussion, sort of to tie it all up, join me in welcoming Julie Gerberding, who used to run the CDC and is now the chief patient officer at Merck. We also expect to have Eric Topol with us. He's the founder and director of the Scripps Institute and a best-selling author. We're working out a few technical hairballs there, Julie. I'm sure you understand, so it'll be you and me at first, and welcome. We're delighted to have you with us. You know, I
look back. I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
We're so glad you could run the anchor leg with us here. You were one of the first people way back in January to sound a kind of clarion call, maybe even before some of the people who are both in government now, including Dr. Fauci and others. You realized that this coronavirus was a beast of an entirely different sort. What told you that?
Well, you know, I had been involved very much in the original SARS outbreak in 2003. And one of the characteristics of that outbreak is that it wasn't very transmissible at the community level. So when I saw the case numbers in China And then when I recognized the situation on the cruise ships and other people in very confined areas, I really could see that this was going to be a much more transmissible problem in the community. And that was frightening.
Did you have a sense beyond the transmissibility of the illness, which was truly alarming, did you have a sense of how deadly and vicious it was?
You know, my first fear was the fact that the original 2003 SARS coronavirus had a very high fatality rate, about 10%. So imagine if this very transmissible virus had that kind of a fatality rate. So I was very worried about how serious this was going to be. When I recognized the data coming out of China that indicated it wasn't as fatal as we had feared, I still didn't feel much relief when the numbers started showing that it was significantly more deadly than influenza. So we were dealing with something that was highly transmissible and had a fatality rate that was significantly higher than what we're used to dealing with in seasonal influenza and even in the 2009 influenza pandemic. So on a global basis, this was a huge threat. And indeed, it proved to be a pandemic of the kind that we haven't seen for a century.
I want to talk a little bit about the experience in China and then the experience that we've had here in the United States with more cases by far than any other country. But I guess I'd like to ask you what we've learned so far about this pandemic, this virus. Was it realistic ever that we or China could contain this virus?
Well, I think it was worth a try. And we have to give China some credit for the fact that they made heroic efforts to try to clamp down and reduce the transmission of this virus. And I think it did buy the world some time so that we could understand a little bit better what was happening there and take some of the steps for preparation that were necessary. So that was not something that you would argue against doing, but it did not prove to be successful. And no one was surprised when we began to see the spillover into other countries and when it ultimately spread across the world. The biggest lesson learned, I think, so far has been that when the world faces a pandemic like this, people can really align around the idea of mitigation and working together to try and reduce the surge in cases so that our health systems have a chance of managing the tremendous burden that they encounter, and that those social distancing measures actually do have an impact. I think we had that hypothesis based on the experience in the 1918 influenza pandemic, but country after country, community after community, we are really seeing the data that the kinds of steps that are intrusive and challenging and difficult for everyone to sustain actually do save lives, slow down the peak of the curve, and ultimately, if we are willing to sustain the course, they will help lower the area under the curve, which means lives will be saved while we are waiting for treatments that reduce mortality or vaccines that can protect us from infection.
Before I bring in Eric Topol, who is now good, Mr. Topol, welcome. We're glad to have you with us. Because we're on a kind of a thread here talking about the origin of this disease in China, I want to ask you, Dr. Gerbening, you know, the Chinese incidence appears to have fallen very, very dramatically. They had a high rise and then a very steep fall off. If the numbers of new cases coming out of China are to be believed, why did that happen there? What can we learn? What can we take from their experience? Or is the takeaway that the Chinese were never really honest about the numbers in the first place and aren't being so now?
Well, of course, I don't have insight into the ground truth in China since I'm not on the government and I'm not privy to some of the confidential communications that are probably going back and forth. But as I said, I think social distancing can really matter. And in China, they have the capacity to impose mandatory social distancing that exceeds anything we could probably imagine experiencing in the United States or in the Western world. So if that is what it takes to really contain the epidemic, we've learned an important lesson there. I suspect, however, that like we're seeing in other countries, as China gets back to business and people begin to resume their normal lives, we're going to see hotspots there because this virus hasn't gone away. And there's nothing that says that the risk today of a hotspot emerging is any less than the risk was several months ago.
Eric Topol, weigh in here. You know, we have about 4% of the world's population in the United States, but we've got something like a third of the coronavirus cases, 28% of the confirmed deaths. Why have we been hit so hard? So much harder than
I think it's right. Well, good to be with you, Tyler and Julie. I think the main issue is that we were so far behind the outbreak. So instead of getting the testing in gear even before it arrived in the U.S. with the first patient January 21st, we were basically paralyzed for at least a month and a half. And at the same time, of course, we know South Korea mobilized, they got testing going right away, and they got in front of the outbreak. So if you just look at that and you look at all the other countries in the world that were successful, and there was over 20 of them, the common theme is that they got testing going early, they had containment, and they wound up with much better outcomes. So we're the main breakdown that led to everything else was just never getting any sense of containment, letting the virus run rampant through the U.S., diffuse spread. And, you know, we're living with that now, unfortunately.
So I guess that leads me to a question, Mr. Topol, about science and government working together. And I'd love, Julie, to hear your thoughts on this as well. And generally speaking, what you just pointed to would be either a failure of science or a failure of government to react quickly enough, or a failure for the two of them to agree and coalesce around a strategy. So talk to me about that and whether science and government, let's focus here on the United States, have been working well together. Eric?
Well, I guess I'd start and say that our government wasn't working because it knew that we needed the tests, but even though they were failing and they were contaminated, there was no backup plan. And so, you know, we were caught flat-footed. And in fact, you know, other countries started testing randomly even before there was a patient in their country. Iceland is notable, but several others as well. So we were totally unprepared. We were in a state of denial, that is some of our leading government officials, that this wasn't even going to come to the U.S., which was, you know, remarkably naive. And so the science, any epidemiologist would know that this was going to come to the U.S., and we just had no readiness whatsoever. And the inability to test for what really turned out to be a couple of months just let this just go like a wildfire through the country. And we are in this irrevocable path, whereas we know that when government and science were aligned and there was the serious nature of how this could be catastrophic, this problem did not occur.
So Julie, weigh in here. Have government and science been sufficiently aligned? Were they both equally quick out of the blocks or not?
Well, I think the answer to that is obvious, but I would also say that there isn't a textbook of the science of how to deal with a brand new pathogen when it emerges. So there has to be learning as well as reliance on what we can extrapolate from previous pandemics. And it's pretty hard to go back and extrapolate from the 1918 pandemic and move that into 2020. But for example, the idea that if you're going to slow down transmission in communities, school closure may be an important part of that. That idea stretches back to the hypotheses that were generated from 1918, but those hypotheses weren't proven. So a lot of the early decisions about what to do to manage containment were not built on the kind of solid science that we wish we had. We just had no experience to develop that science. Now we are learning, and I think we have increasing confidence as we understand the transmission coefficients and the dynamics of this, that as we go forward from this point in time, it's pretty obvious where we need to concentrate our containment efforts and the kinds of testing modalities and the interventions that are going to be necessary to keep us from reemerging into another steep upslope on the transmission curve.
So since you mentioned learnings, Julie, a question from one of our participants is, what are the deep learnings you're taking away from COVID-19, and how do you think they can be used to improve our overall healthcare system? I'll ask the same question to you, Eric, in just a moment.
The serious and I think most tragic learning in all of this is how fragile our health system is when it comes to managing surge capacity. Now, this was something that was known and has been an issue several times in recent years when we've had a bad flu season, or in 2009 when we had the flu pandemic. But we really have not yet sufficiently invested in surge. Our health systems operate on thin margins and try to minimize the unnecessary utilization or stockpiling, so to speak, of resources. And yet when we see a requirement that exceeds our baseline capacity, it's really hard to meet that capacity. And so the incredible effort on the part of health workers, Merck and Pfizer and Lilly came together and said, we have many health workers, let's allow them to volunteer and pay their salaries so that we can help augment the healthcare workforce, which was spread so thin. These are problems that should have been anticipated, and yet they're very difficult to solve. We don't have the mentality that pandemic preparedness is a national security capacity that we need to manage in the same way we manage our defense capacity, so that we have something available if we need it and just pray that we don't. So I think that's really one of the most important things I hope changes as we go forward, that we will have redundancies and capabilities to manage surge. On the other side of the learning, though, there is a good piece of this, and that is the science, and that we have really, I think, understood that science has advanced so far. It's on our side, and we're really beginning to identify the marvelous engagements, as we've been hearing all afternoon, in the antivirals, the immunologic therapies, and the vaccines that hopefully will come down the pike sooner rather than later.
Eric, I guess it's early to come away with deep learnings, because as we began this this day, we asked Dr. Gottlieb, what inning are we in? And he said, maybe we're in the second inning, and this may be a doubleheader. We don't know whether this is going to come back. But talk to me a little bit about, from where you sit, what are the deep learnings? And I note another question, and I know it's one that you have an opinion on, and that is from one of the viewers. How rapidly is the virus mutating? Knock that one out first, maybe, and then go to the deep learning.
Yeah, well, that's one thing that's really fortunate, Tyler, is the virus is not mutating in any rapid way. In fact, it's quite slow. And so while that gives a wonderful ability for genomicists to track the virus from state to state, country to country, just by those mutations that are basically innocent, we haven't seen a new strain at all. And so that's one of the only good things about the COVID-19 virus story. Mutations, yes, but they're basically just good for detective work, for tracking the virus and nothing more. There is no evidence that there's been a mutation that is of pathogenic, that is worse transmissibility or worse potency or anything like that.
And what about that learning question?
Learning, usually I ascribe deep learning for artificial intelligence, but for deep neural networks. But here, our learning hopefully is substantial, because this, I think, is the greatest public health blunder, catastrophe in the history of the country. So hopefully we'll learn a lot. But, you know, the one thing that we have to learn besides preparedness is that we have a very shaky information system. So we are the third largest country in the world, and instead of having all our data together, like so many other countries that have real health systems, learning health systems, I'll give you an example. In the UK, they have this ICNARC, which is every ICU patient, real time, being able to learn from each of those patients. So for example, if you know that mechanical ventilation could make people worse, you're going to learn that much sooner than in the US, where we have lack of cohesiveness. We're just so incredibly not coalesced with that rich data that we could have to help guide us and learn from every patient. So that's something that we need to work on in the future.
Okay. I'm going to ask a couple of questions about reopening the economy, and then we'll go to a kind of lightning round with the time we have, and we'll spill over just a little bit. Dr. Fauci this morning, Dr. Gerberding, said in front of Congress that we risk needless suffering and death if we reopen society too soon and have to and then run the risk of reinfection or a spread of it. As we have seen in some of the states where steps have been taken to reopening the economy, the case count has been rising and rising rather dramatically. On the other hand, the testing count in some of those cases has been rising rather dramatically as well. So there's a confusion, I would think, among epidemiologists to the point of, are we seeing more cases because we're reopening, or are we identifying more cases because we are testing more? So how do you get to the bottom of this? And if you are a policymaker or an epidemiologist, make the conclusion that we reopen too soon or not?
Well, first of all, the frame of this is the fact that while there are hot spots where many people have been infected, as a population of people across the United States, the vast majority of us have not been infected and we are not immune and we remain susceptible. So anything that introduces the virus into that population of people is prone to set up another hot spot and increase the probability of transmission. That's just a fact, and we don't need testing and a lot of other interventions to figure that out. I do think that the epidemiologists have a tough job because testing is all over the map. And we also recognize that now we have a variety of tests, some of which are more accurate than others. So we have that confounder. But the lagging indicator, and the one that probably is the most meaningful in terms of the morbidity and mortality of the recrudescence, is the hospital utilization. And that we don't need a test to observe. We can count the number of patients who are admitted and the number of people who are in the intensive care unit. And as those numbers begin to increase, we know that we've gone too far in relieving our social distancing. It's tragic to have to get to that point, but that's exactly what Dr. Fauci was trying to say this morning, is that if that's what we do, we can anticipate that we will pay a big price.
That's very interesting. We were speaking yesterday in a different venue. I was to the mayor of Scottsdale, Arizona, and he made exactly that point, that the real telltale for him is hospital admissions, ICU admissions, and that you don't need a test to administer to know about that. You have the real numbers. Mr. Tobel, you mentioned earlier sort of the slowness and speaking with conflicting voices, and it feels to me as though the messaging around coronavirus has been there's been a lot of dissonant messaging. We've got tests for everybody. No, we don't. Yes, we do. This is going to go away. No, it isn't. There's been a lot. It's a serious threat. No, it isn't. There's been a lot of conflicting messaging that I think has confused people. Am I right?
No, absolutely. No, I think, if you go back to, March 6th, when everyone could have a test, and we still aren't there here in May. So, no, there's been terrible problems with mixed and mis-messaging. And I think that has certainly set us back as well. But, I think that the problem was that we were flying blind during those months, part of January, all of February, and the first half of March. And now we're flying blind again because we don't have the testing infrastructure in place. The other thing that we could do, of course, is get digital surveillance. We've already seen this week a report about using smartphone apps for just collecting symptoms. And what we can also do is, get resting heart rate. If we did that for 100 million people, or a tiny fraction of that, of Americans that have a fitness band or a smartwatch, we could get resting heart rate as a way to not fly blind while we're waiting for the testing infrastructure to get hold. What I'm amazed about, Tyler, is that we've had all these weeks of relative lockdowns or absolute lockdowns, and we still haven't gotten this testing story right. And of course, the problem is if you don't get that right, and that includes testing people who don't have any symptoms, even random testing at scale, we haven't done that yet. And if you don't do that, you're not ready to do contact tracing and isolation.
Yeah.
So we the basic steps here, we're just violating.
I guess I find we'll skip on beyond this, but the idea of using smart devices for patient monitoring, Americans have a very ambiguous, ambivalent relationship with sharing personal data. On the one hand, they're very scared of an intrusive government listening to what they do or say. On the other hand, they're more than happy to share their location with Waze all the time to help them get through traffic. But I see a big opportunity there for personal monitoring devices. Dr. Gerberding, let me go back to question about reopening the economy. Can we ever really go back to a fully reopened economy unless we have an effective vaccine against this disease? And how hopeful are you that we will be able to come up with a vaccine? Coronavirus is the common cold. Common cold is a coronavirus, and we have no vaccine against that. What tells you we'll be able to have a vaccine on this? And will we really go back to normal until we do?
Well, let me say a few things about the vaccine. And I say this with some humility because Merck did cross the finish line with a vaccine for Ebola that was developed under somewhat similar circumstances, an emergent public health crisis in Western Africa, and then a second public health crisis in the Eastern DRC. And I think some of the things we learned there in that context is that when you have an emergency like this, you really do rally the biopharmaceutical ecosystem to come to the rescue. And people will put aside their competitive pressures or the things that are normally on their plate and work hard to try to contribute to solutions. These situations demand multiple shots on goal. We saw that with Ebola, and we're certainly seeing it now with more than 130 antivirals and many dozens of vaccine candidates, some of which are in clinical trials already. So those shots on goal is important, and I think that allows us to have more confidence that something will cross the finish line that will be valuable and hopefully provide durable protection. The bar for safety is very high in this regard. So we can't promise that we're going to get the right balance of a great vaccine that's also very safe in the fastest manner possible, but we should be hopeful that we have the prospect of doing that. And ultimately, the way to end a pandemic, we have three choices and all could come into play. One is that we do find treatments that lower the fatality rate and the hospitalization rate to the point where it is more like seasonal influenza and we can manage it. Or we develop a vaccine that offers protective immunity to broad swaths of the population. Or worst case scenario, we just wait until enough people have had it that we develop population level herd immunity and the epidemic can't be propagated. I'm most hopeful that we'll find antivirals fast. I think the prospects for a vaccine are an area where we should be optimistic, but the timeline is challenging. And herd immunity will eventually happen one way or another, but I hope and pray that that isn't what we have to resort to.
One last question to you, Dr. Gerberding, before I go back to Eric for our final question of the afternoon. There's been increased worry about children, and at one point there was some thinking that children were relatively resistant to this virus, but we've seen lots of cases now in which the illness is either detected or some other manifestation of this illness, something like an inflammatory response like Kawasaki has taken effect. Talk to me a little bit about that. And then answer a couple of questions that I asked Dr. Gottlieb this morning. If you had a young child, would you send that young child to sleepaway camp this summer, day camp this summer? And what about going to either a public or a swim club swimming pool?
So yeah, I think the situation with the pediatric, the young, very, very young infants, as well as children, is confusing. As we typically expect for basically every respiratory virus with which I'm familiar, that the children will be the sort of cesspool where the virus gets transmitted in daycare or schools, and that children are really important in the transmission at a community level. Now, clearly, we know children are not immune to this virus. We have plenty of examples where children have been ill and hospitalized, but they are a minority of the cases. And so that suggests that either they manage it as a mild upper respiratory illness and that doesn't go any further, or there's something about their receptor status or their host immune response that protects them from developing the symptomatic disease. We don't know how capable they are of transmitting even when asymptomatic, but as we see the epidemic expand and we have the opportunity to study the disease more closely, the awareness that some children do develop this very difficult kind of autoimmune disorder called something like Kawasaki's disease, if it's not exactly Kawasaki's disease. This is a very serious and often fatal condition. And so it just tells us that we have a lot to learn and we better keep an open mind about their status of our children in this context. So if I had young children, I have to admit that I would not send my young children to camp or to the swimming club this summer until I was confident that my community was not a place where there was active transmission. I hope I'm wrong about that. And as the studies that Dr. Topol's been talking about get conducted and we understand better the true bottom of the iceberg that is there under the tip, which are all the cases with symptoms and in hospitals, I hope as we understand the true prevalence of the disease in our communities, we will get answers to this question. And I hope that happens sooner rather than later.
I'll guarantee you, there are millions of parents, including this one, who hope that you are, that your hope proves true and that camp is able to happen and swim days are able to happen. Eric, wrap us up here. We've obviously seen a major outbreak in this country, in Italy, in Great Britain, and to lesser extents in other countries. But there are other parts of the world where this disease has not ripped through yet the way one might expect. How worried are you about what could happen as this disease begins to manifest in countries that are even less prepared than we are or were to contend with it? Countries like Brazil, countries in Central and Sub-Saharan Africa, countries in Asia and maybe Latin America.
All right. Well, I think the ones that have signed on now to be major trouble spots, countries, are certainly Brazil, as you mentioned, Tyler, India and Russia. Those are the ones that are really on the rise. And to add to that, Mexico. We haven't yet seen the signal of this diffuse spread with cases and fatalities throughout the continent of Africa, but that's certainly a major liability going forward. So, you know, I think this is what many of us think there will be a second cycle that Tony Fauci referred to earlier today and also I know was discussed throughout this program, not the rebound story, but as it cycles around the world because of these other continents that are just now kind of showing up. But just to think that the U.S. is in the same category as Brazil, India, and Russia as to its response, it's really has to be categorized as a pathetic response. Now, on the other hand, you know, we are really good at things like developing neutralizing antibodies and drugs and vaccines. And so that's the sanguine side of this. And hopefully that will be good for all people in the world, not just those in the US. So we have a counterbalancing of seeing momentum, really unprecedented momentum in the programs for drugs and neutralizing antibodies, convalescent plasma, and the vaccine. So hopefully, as these other continents show what is inevitable, and we go through what it will be a 2 or 3 year story at the least with respect to additional cycles and ever presence, you know, we'll have remedies. And I do think that in the months ahead, we'll see the fatality rate drop down because we're starting to see therapies that are proven to be effective. And one just other note, I should have mentioned, Tyler, when you asked about the messaging, the mask story was just, you know, really abominable, that we shouldn't wear masks because there weren't enough masks, that we should wear masks. So this has just been part and parcel of the problem of not having a consistent, uniform, you know, science-based communication. I hope we'll see that improve, because this is going to be a long haul. And as Scott asserted earlier today in the program, you know, whatever inning you want to put it in, it's in the early phases.
Lots of lessons learned, and we've certainly learned a lot today. Dr. Topol, thank you for leaving us with that, on that hopeful note. Dr. Gerbrinks, as someone who's on the front lines in this fight, working with your researchers at Merck and elsewhere in the industry, we thank you. And thank you both for your time today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right, we've come to the end of our session today, and I want to thank all of our speakers for their contributions and their time. And I want to thank you, the viewers, for your participation and being patient with us as we worked out a couple of little kinks in the system. To our sponsors, Hospital for Special Surgery and Vanda Pharmaceuticals, you have our enduring gratitude. And to access video from today's event and ongoing coverage, you can visit the Healthy Returns website. You can just get out your camera right now, point it there at the QR code on the screen. I don't know what it'll do for you, but it'll probably take you to a good place where you can learn more about this. Stay in touch using the CNBC events handle. You can check out our podcast, where we clip some of the highlights of events like these on the keynote. You can get that wherever you get your podcasts. And I should point out that all registrants, like you, will be signed up for the weekly Healthy Returns newsletter. It features the best reporting that we have on healthcare from our entire broadcast and .com team. And most importantly, once again, the thanks to all of our speakers, to all of you who participated today, and to all of the people who are helping us get through this. Have a good rest of the day. Stay safe.